Shalom, shalom, Israel. This is your teacher, Eric, brother, pastor, shepherd, friend. So, hey, much love. Welcome again to another teaching where iron will sharpen iron and we will be edified in the name of the Most High, Yah. And I have things kind of moved around today because I'm going to be using my backboard a lot. So I got my computer stuff over here. So this is why I keep looking this way to try to monitor and to try to talk at the same time, all right? So let me know how I am coming in, and I'm gonna be now looking this way. So now I'm gonna be looking this way to greet you all. Much love, seeing we have His Word alive, Shabbat Shalom. Much love to you, Brother Rio, Shabbat Shalom. Much love, Brother Rio. Hey, Brother John Campbell, Shabbat Shalom. Yahspeed, Shabbat Shalom. Brother Mike, Shabbat Shalom. Combat G, saying Shabbat Shalom. Brother Michael, Shabbat Shalom, my brother. Hebrew Israel in the house, Shabbat Shalom. We have David. See how you kind of get when we don't know how to pronounce. But hey, Shabbat Shalom anyway, right? Hey, Brother Paul, Shabbat Shalom. We have Faith, Shabbat Shalom. What do we have here? I pray everyone has a blessed week in Yeshua's name. Yeah, click thumbs up. You know, give us a like. We got tens coming in and commenting, liking on the video. It sounds cheesy. It sounds cliche, but it actually gets the gospel out there on these platforms. It shoves it forward. So other people can listen in here. Are you excited? Are you excited today to hear the message of the Most High? I get so excited for this, excited to come together with our family and to do what? Bring forth a restoration and to send out the gospel message. That's what we are charged to do. So it's my job to shepherd you and prepare you and to raise you individually up so you can do what? Spread the gospel, go out, preach, teach, show people. The thing is again, you're not charged to go out there and minister to people and then say, hey, let me tell you about my beautiful Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, and the truth. Go watch this YouTube channel. Here, go check this video out. No, you're to be the ones to feed them with knowledge and understanding. They don't even know who I am. But you just see that a lot. Now, do we want you to share the messages to get the word out there? Yes. But when you're talking to your friends, when you're talking to your family, when you're talking to your coworkers, when you're talking to the people in the line at the grocery store, it rests on your shoulders to be the light. I mean, do you sit there and I don't have my phone or even around me, but say, hey, strike up a conversation. I want to tell you about Yeshua. Check this video out. Hand them the phone. That'd be kind of weird, wouldn't it? Getting some blank looks and stares. Let's get ready to kick this off. And I will have my wife go ahead and quote the Ten Commandments. Make sure this is on. Should be live.
And Yahweh spoke all these words saying, I am Yahweh, the Elohim, who brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim, out of the house of slavery. You should have no other gods before me. You should not make in yourself any graven image or any likeness of that which is in the heavens above, or which is the earth beneath, or which is the waters under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down yourself to them, nor serve them. For I am Yahweh, the Elohim, and my jealous El, visiting the crookedness of the fathers on the children, to the third and fourth generations of those that hate me, but showing love and commitment to the thousands of those that love me and guard my command. Do not take the Lord's name of God in vain, for he will not hold him guiltless who brings his name to naught. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. For 6 days Yah made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. But rest is the seventh day. Wherefore, Yah bless the seventh day and hallowed it. Honor your father and your mother, so your days are prolonged upon the soil which the Lord your God has given thee. Thou shalt not murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness against your neighbor. Thou shalt not cover your neighbor's house. Thou shalt not cover your neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his female servant, nor his ox, nor his donkey. That's where it belongs to your neighbors. So be it.
So be it. Hallelujah. Glory to the King. Need that. And all right, so let's kick it off. Now, if you're on Facebook, I'm going to remember to come and to kill the Facebook feed because sure enough, I left it up. I actually forgot about it last week and it did the same stinking thing. It cut part of my audio out and doing all this stuff. So on Facebook, We're going to try to get everybody over here. I started on Facebook because I have a lot of people on there that aren't over here on YouTube. So if you're on Facebook, you need to come to the YouTube Teacher Eric Robinson channel. All right, let me go ahead and get a prayer sounded off. Father, we just humbly come before you. We thank you that you invited us to keep the Shabbat and that you invited our beautiful family and those that are obedient are here of like mind and we're of one mind that we want to hear your words of truth and we don't want our ears tickled, but we want it to bring forth a change in our life that increases our relationship with you and strengthens us to be a light to the nations. We thank you for all these things. Let the Holy Spirit have his way. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ. So be it. Glory to the King. Hallelujah. Let's kick it off. Today we're going to be talking about the culture of the Bible. Is there a culture, a divine culture that Yahweh has given you? And the thing is, lots of people believe that's in the Bible, and we don't see a culture that comes from heaven drop down on the Israelites in the Bible. We've talked about this before. Here is a family, and so I'm going to bring you guys into all of this. And what I want to start with is that Torah should influence your culture. I'm going to Shabbat Shalom. See what the children made? And my wife was part of that, right? Beautiful artwork. Okay, I'm going to draw a timeline. Go like this. And I'll run it across here. And everybody in here can see that, right? You can see it. So I'm not going to go about what exact date the earth was created and get into all these arguments of young earth, old earth, because that's not the point of today's teaching. So I'm just going to start here like 40th century BC. Okay. 20th century BC. 10th century BC. Right? Then we have first century when Yeshua is on the scene. 80, 10th. 80, 15th, 80, and then we got a happy little tree right here. And let's give it a little cloud friend. Can't do the Bob Ross. You guys are the younger ones are probably like, what is this guy even talking about right now? So now we're in the 20th century AD. So we see that, right? This is your life, Israel. So in this life, as we live life, we have a culture that changes not only according to the time frame, okay, depending what century it is, but also according to geographical location. And at the time that we have these biblical writings, this biblical canon that we have, you know, all these Hebrew poetries and writings of the ancient people and stories all collected and bound together and organized in a certain order by scribes through divine inspiration to communicate a story that leads us to Yeshua HaMashiach and his redeeming salvation, right? So we have this here, and this is what all of this talks about. And in the time that this is written here, this all took place in around about the same geographical location, right? You didn't have it taking place over and clear into the west side of the world or over way, way, way well in the south. It was all in that ancient Near Eastern region of the Bible. And I could have gotten a map, but I didn't do that. But go Google a map of the ancient Bible period, and they will show you where that is. And it's not, it's large, but it's not like whole earth large, right? So when they say whole world in the Bible, are they talking about the whole earth? In the biblical literature, they're talking about that geographical location most of the time. Other times it does imply to everywhere, but most of the time it's to their geographical region and is the way that they communicated. So we have this, and we know that because they're from the same vicinity, a lot of cultures are shared in amongst the different nations. We got that? You kind of tracking with me a little bit? So in this, we have, that's our life, the life of the people. And throughout it, we have, I want to go like this, culture. We have culture flowing in and out. So then I want to draw this. Bang. Go up there. Maybe try to do a little bit of a different color. So we have the Torah of Yah. Okay. Known as the Ten Commandments. So this is the covenant, the Torah. This represents the Torah, the Ten Principles. Because you have the Ten Principles of Torah written on the granite, right? Or written on the rock. By what? The finger of Yah. Those Ten Torahs or Ten Principles are just that. You need the rest of the Tanakh, the rest of Torah, to explain what these principles are, right? To expound on them. Because if it says on here that thou shalt not murder, okay, or on this side, thou shalt not murder, then we have to go in and define what murder is, and the way that we do that is in the Torah. I've told you that before. We're all there, right? So you have Torah, and Torah has a direct effect on culture. That was the idea. So Torah comes down, bang. And whatever time period you are in, ladies and gentlemen, Torah should and will have a dramatic effect on that. So Torah has an effect or effect effectively changes, alters culture. So Torah should effectively change or alter your culture. And I'm going to click back over here. See where I can see everybody. Make sure I'm coming in good. And we see it now. So I don't forget, if you're on Facebook, I'm going to be clicking off of Facebook right now. So you need to get your rear ends over to YouTube. Okay? So here we go. I'm heading up. And you're going to miss a lot of good stuff if you don't get over here. So remove. Make sure we're still alive and we're still good and I can see comments. Okay, so we should be alive and good. All right, so I'm going to let you look at this. Now, Torah will influence your culture. It's going to mold and it's going to shape it into one that is in compliance. So this needs to comply to this. Your culture changes and shifts on who even you hang around, tribes and things like that. It's going to be a little bit different from tribe to tribe, a little bit different from geographical region to geographical region. But one thing's constant, and that's the Torah of the Most High Yah. His law does not change. He does not alter anything that comes out of his lips. And so what is a constant affirmation should influence and change the culture. However, Yahweh did not object, and we're going to see this throughout the Bible, to the people having a culture of their own design. He didn't remove their culture and replace it with a new one of his own. He worked with the culture that they were already in, and he gave directions concerning and bringing restrictions in to the culture. We need to observe how he did this in order to apply it to ourselves in the 21st century where we are scattered. And that's where a lot of people just, they run into so much confusion out there. And it's people, whether they are Torah keepers, believing in Yeshua HaMashiach, or whether they're Jews only clinging to Torah, denying Messiah, or whether they are from Christianity, acceptance of Messiah, a different Messiah that they say came and nailed the law to the cross so they don't have to obey the law anymore. And we know from 1 John chapter 3, verse 4, that the definition of sin is breaking Yahweh's law. That's how you define sin. Paul even said in Romans that God forbid we do away with the law because I wouldn't even know what sin is if not what? By the law. The law defines what sin is. The law is Yahweh's definition of good and evil on his terms, right? So we don't read in the Bible where Yahweh disapproved fully of the culture of the people, took away the culture, and gave them a brand new culture. Now, you may say, gosh, I'm a little confused, because do we see cultures in the Bible all over the place? And would you develop and have a culture that is running with the world, and then the Torah comes in, shatters your world, right? You have to die to the old man and be resurrected anew, and you put away all the old things and take on Yahweh's way. Are you going to have a completely reformed culture that you live? Yes. And as the body of believers grows and it grows, do you, through community, have a refashioned culture? Well, absolutely. However, will you still have things contained in that culture that are, like, say, private or formed and fashioned in the geographical location and in the year that you lived in? Absolutely, as well. And again, we will see that today. You see, the Bible, it's a compilation of oral stories and literary works that have been gathered throughout the centuries. And many of you may be shocked that as of today, the oldest Hebraic writings that we have found date back to like the 3rd century. The Tanakh that we have, which the Tanakh is what they would commonly today call the Old Testament, that was transitioned orally throughout the people. And they would have certain scroll writings and things collected that were written down, but its final composition and order didn't fully take place until like 200 to 300 BC, in which is what we have today in our Bibles, what they would call the Hebrew Bible. So they had versions and things. So you had editors coming along that under divine inspiration were composing and putting together this beautiful piece of literature that we have before us today. And in fact, the Gospels weren't put into order and fully collected until like the 9th or 10th century BC. And that's a stumbling block for a lot of people to learn. They're like, what? Like, we're talking 700 to 1,000 years after Messiah that the Gospels weren't organized and collected and put together? Yeah, and there shouldn't be any problem with that. There shouldn't be any problem with that, right? So we're going to break all this down. And in fact, just to clarify the full thing, when Luke went out and he started to put in his orders and get everything collected from all the people, that was like 70 AD. So you have Yeshua, his death around 40 AD, 30 years in between, 70 AD. You have Luke going around in Acts, collecting writings and collecting firsthand accounts from disciples and from witnesses that were there. It says it in Acts. So I want to be clear about that. Well, I'm talking about the order and the organization of your Bible that you have today when it was fully put in order, okay? When I'm talking about we're going into 9th century, just to be clear. All right, so let's get into this a little bit more. I want to be able to show slides, so let's see how this will work for us here. And yes, we go. So let me bring you into the big, well, I want to go like this. Let's see how we can do this. I'm just going to start here. All right. So when I talked about Hebrew poetry, and again, my mind's going 1,000 different ways, and I spent the last couple of weeks thinking how I would organize this and bring this in, and there's so much that I don't want to go 4 or 5 or 6 hours or make this a 18-part series. So I want to give you guys out there just an overview of what's going on in my mind, what we talk about here as a family all the time. And then we'll have more diving into each area as we go forward in the weeks to come. All right, does that make sense? So let me talk a little bit about the Hebraic poetry of the Bible. And I'm gonna make this a little bigger like this. So this all is gonna hopefully come together, right? When we read in the Bible and we see people and we see a culture, and then this is what the premise is. And then we think, because we're going back to keep Torah, that we need to go and we need to relive that ancient culture. We need to bring it forward in every way that they live life, even outside of Torah, that Yah even had no problem with, that's the way we need to live life today. And that isn't always the case, because a lot of things are written in Hebraic poetry to the people. So When you have the biblical authors, right? When you have the prophets and they're wanting to communicate to the people and tell them of the vision that they saw. And we're going to see this in the next coming weeks when I take you in and show you how the Bible was put together and these writings were put together. It was not that the biblical authors, their eyes would roll back in the head, okay? And they would have their animal skin and ink, and it'll go like that. And they would begin to just write, and they would get done, and they would say, wow, this is amazing, and they'd have all these scrolls, and they would need to read through them, like Jeremiah would need to read through them to see what it is he said. You have times where Yahweh will communicate directly to an individual, and he'll say, write this down as I'm communicating it to your mind. You have other times that Yah, and most of the time, he shows a vision, whether in dream, whether you're sitting there and you go into a trance. Once it's over, Yah says to the individual, record these things that I have shown you. Now it's up to that individual in his own words to write down what Yah showed him. Does that take away divine inspiration? We're getting no's here. And yeah, because we've talked about this before. It absolutely should not take away divine inspiration. But there's a lot of people, could be some of you on the other side of this camera, with what I just said, would all be like a mind blow. Like, what? What are you? You're trying to say that these are men that just wrote? Yeah. And the Bible tells you how it came into being. We'll go through all of that. We'll see that together. So Yah takes an individual like Jeremiah, I'm just going to stick on him, that he formed in the womb, and he knew before he even came in the womb what he was called to do and predestined to do. So he forms that individual throughout all the childhood, teenage years, young man years, all the things that they experienced, went through, read, the experiences they had with the people, prepared them for the mission that Yahweh has for them. Yah does the same thing with each and every one of you out there, where you can look out back on your life and see everything that you did and went through, prepared you, and made you the man or woman that you needed to be today to be a light to the nations. So going with that mindset, isn't it strange that those of us today that have a pastor or a shepherd individual like me, that when they speak a word and they're preaching and teaching, you take it as thus saith Yahweh, right? In sense that man is a mouthpiece to Yah. I will follow that man as he follows Yah, but I believe him to be divinely inspired, shouting what Yah was communicating to him. Are we there? Do we get that? Okay. Yes. So do any of you think, and many of you out there may nod your heads in agreement, like, Eric, we believe that about you. And I always charge you, you follow Yeshua first and foremost. So if I step out of the lines of Yeshua HaMashiach, you follow Yeshua HaMashiach. I'm an under-shepherd to the great shepherd. There's only one teacher. There's only one pastor, and there's only one shepherd. That's Yeshua HaMashiach. Call no other man the teacher and the rabbi that is of his esteem. All of us that are called, I'll give you pastors according to my heart in Jeremiah 3:15. We are those that are the under-shepherds. We're working and teaching what the great shepherd already taught us. So go and you follow him first and foremost. So now that I've said that, how many of you out there believe that when I'm preparing a sermon, that my eyes roll in the back of my head, my hand goes like this and grabs a pen and just starts writing, or I go over to the MacBook in the 21st century and I'm like this and I get done and I'm like, boy, I have to read what it is that Yahweh wants for us today. Most of you say, no, I don't believe that that happens, Eric. And if you told us that that's what happened, we might start to actually question you a little bit if I told you that that's what happened to me each and every week. And she's looking at me like, is that what happened? That's not what happens to Daddy each and every week. However, have I got up here like last week and weeks prior and have every, and like to this week, I try to prepare and have every line and I dotted, right? T crossed, I dotted, and have everything organized in an outline form. And then Yahweh comes in and he goes, oh, I'm taking you a different direction today. Yeah, that's divine inspiration. But how am I preaching what Yahweh is communicating through me? Through everything I've experienced in my life, through all the stuff that I went through that prepared me for this moment, for this day. Do we see that? But when we go back to biblical literature, you may not have thought about it too much before, but that's the way we approach the Bible, is that these men, eyes rolled in the back of their head, they black out, and when they wake up, there's a stack of scrolls sitting there. The Bible doesn't even say that the Bible came into communication. So these prophets, the way that they would often organize and find ways to communicate is through story form. Yeshua, did he not communicate through parables? Did he not do that? And he said, so that those that are my taught ones, you would have a greater understanding. Why? Because I will explain to you the mystery of the parable. But because the parable is spoken in a mystery, the people on the outside, according to the prophet Isaiah and Yeshua's own lips, that they wouldn't understand what I'm saying, and then their hearts would be converted. Mind-blowing to modern Christianity. Mind-blowing. That Yeshua would speak in such a way, if they don't get it, they don't get it. Yeshua didn't even argue with all the Pharisees and the Sadducees that came up trying him for his doctrine, but yet people today feel like they need to get into debates and all these squabbles and back and forth with every other pastor that there is out there, and they're at war with every other ministry out there, that their ministry is the best ministry on earth. Yeshua didn't have to do that. He didn't have anything to prove. He would rebuke and correct. And when those Pharisees and Sadducees would look at him and have no idea some of the time what he was even saying, Yeshua just walked away. Walked away. Done. Let this be recorded in history for those that have a heart that are willing to hear. So your job out there isn't to save every single person on the face of planet Earth. Your job out there is not to just wear out the doorstep in the ear of your family members that aren't wanting to hear what you have to say. And every time you're around, you're that annoying person that just can't quit preaching at them all the time. Yeshua didn't even do that. Yeshua said, no, I will be a light. I'll be an example. I'm a banner raised up for the nations. Those will hear, they will see the good works that are being done, and they will be drawn in, such as the Bible. So the Bible, like I was saying, Yeshua communicating in parables to the people, so did the biblical authors, and they would communicate in Hebraic poetry. Now, this Hebraic poetry has also been mentioned as being a poetic parallelism. And you'll know the poetic parallelisms. I'll show you the first one that we have in our biblical canon today. But the parallelisms are where you see things repeated a lot. Like there'll be a sentence in the Bible, and right beneath it, it repeats the same thing, just kind of in a slightly different way, and then three or four repeats it another way. That's Hebraic poetry to the people. Because when I would read, I would wonder, why is it repeating all these things? It doesn't even make sense. But the biblical authors would speak in a poetic form and a poetic story in order to give people understanding. So that will bring us to the first one we have in the Bible, which is Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. So this is Hebraic poetic parallelism. And what we have here is, so Elohim created man in his own image. In the image of Elohim, he created he, him. There's your repetition. Male and female, he created them. So in Hebraic poetry, and we'll dive into more of the poetic things and other teachings because we could spend hours there. It'll usually go three or four sentences in a poetic, if you want to call it a stanza or however you want to call it. You know, we'll get there. And you'll see repetitions of words playing off of one another back and forth, okay? So where are some of the dangers? And this is the mind flow that I'm bringing you through, that if you don't understand cultural effect, if you don't understand the Hebraic poetry, that you will misinterpret scripture. And this one right here is one that's misinterpreted by some. In fact, a pastor that I was close to was saying that if you say that a female is created in the image of Yah, then that's a false heretic doctrine. Women are not created in the image of Yah. That women are created in the image of man. Well, again, I wrote a little article on this. I put it up on the video, Image of Yah. I can link it in this description of this video if you want to see it later when this video is reposted and explain it there. I don't want to go through it all now, but even by default, look around your room where you're at right now. Do you have males and females there? Does the female kind of look like the males in the room? That's humanity. That's Adam. That's the image of Yah. And so the image of Yah is on earth to subdue and to rule it as kings and queens, to be, to image Yah on earth. The images of Yah have certain rights to them that the non-images of Yah do not have. The non-images of Yah are to be ruled over. So if you have a woman not in the image of Yah, then she does not have all the rights as men do. Abort them, murder them, mistreat them, beat them. Torah doesn't apply to them. Torah applies and guides the images of Yahweh to carry out his entity here on earth to represent him. So that then we look at us, they see who? Yah. And we need the Torah to come down and shape and to mold us to properly image him, right? So when you read this and you see, so Elohim created man in his own image. And they say, look, there's man. But we have to know, what is that word man? And that word man in the Hebraic is Adam. And I put it down here so you can see it. I will actually give you the full screen. And you can see, so Elohim created man is Hebrew 1:20, Adam. And that means to go into mankind, humanity, humanity. In his own image, he created them male and female. Male and female are the binary components of Adam, humanity. And I'm getting somewhere. Let me go like this. And so you can see in Bereshit 5:1, it says, this is the book of the generations. There's a word in English translated Adam, but it's actually not the same word as humankind. It's humans, humanity. Male and female binary compositions that make up humanity. There's only two genders, okay, that make up humanity, all right? That word is Adam, but it's the Hebrew 1:21 variant, which means man, Adam, first man, ready, all right? So when you see that word, Hebrew 1:21, that refers to Adam, the first man only. But when you see the Hebrew 1:20, that refers to mankind. I said all of that to say this. We have in Genesis 1, these are the book of the generations of Adam, man, only one, right? First man. In the day that Elohim created mankind, it's saying man again, but the Hebrew 1:20 is the masculine noun for humanity. So when the Hebrew Israelite authors would translate and write, they would build off their masculine formation, okay? You'll see. So Hebrew noun, masculine noun, man, right there you can see on the screen, Hebrew 1:20, in the likeness of Elohim, he made he him, referring back to the masculine noun, Adam, humanity. So what am I saying? When you have the authors writing, they're going to say, made he him, referring to humanity in its masculine format. Do we get all of that? We don't do that. We would say them in English. So we would finish that, and an English author would say, in the likeness of Elohim, he made them. Hebraic does not do that that way. It's not necessary for them to do that. It's not wrong. Genesis 5:2, and that's also, we would know this when it speaks laws to the people and it's only speaking in a masculine format. Does it apply to the women too? Can women eat pork? Can women do whatever they want? No, they can't, right? Women have to obey the same Torah guidelines. Women need to keep Shabbat too, okay? So male and female, both binary compositions of Adam, created he them and blessed them. He called their name Adam, humanity 1:20. So in the image of Yah, Adam, masculine, man was created, mankind was created. Yahweh is saying right here in Bereshit 5:2 that when he says Adam in that masculine noun, he's saying humanity. In the day that they were created, and then the author right there, or the translator, is using it, they, it says just he was created. It flip-flops back and forth. So if you don't understand biblical poetry, if you don't understand what the Bible was intended to do, then you're going to misinterpret things like this, and you're going to come up with doctrines that make men beneath man, and they're more of a non-human creature. Women, that women are a non-human creature, that they're just as a dog. They have the same rights as a dog does if they're not created in the image of Yah. But this is where you have to study. This is where you need to know Hebrew literature, Hebrew words, vernacular, the way that they're comprised and put together. Then you have what we have today, this Bible that was translated into English, and we thank Yah for it. But now we have another hurdle to cross, is the English authors, the mistakes and errors that they made. Does that mean that the Bible is not divinely inspired? That's not what I'm saying. But you have people that are, say, King James onlyist. I've seen their churches and their preachings and teachings, and they say that everything in the King James Bible is infallible. There's not one editorial mistake. There's not no errors whatsoever at all. It's perfect. And they believe that, and they're gravely mistaken. We don't have perfect translations today. All right, let me take it a little bit further. I think we're all tracking here, and I'm looking down, and we got speaking truth, praise Yah, so good. We are tracking. Okay, and let me show you this. We're going to go into a little bit of I'll go like this. Bam. Okay, leave that on the screen a little bit. We're going to talk about culture just a little bit, like the definitions of it. So culture is language, social behavior, art, literature, music and dance, clothing, customs and traditions, shelter, your house, like what it looks like from different cultures, your house, homes will look a little bit different. Your religion, huge in culture. You know, that you didn't have the separation of religion and culture for the longest period of time. So your tongue, I'm not going to break each one of these down, but I'm just going to say a couple. Like your language, your tongue is going to tell where you're from. If you live here and you speak like this, Josie, like I said, hey, could you go get me a cup of water? Could you tell me where the loo is? It's like a kind of a British accent, right? And if I talk like that, that's going to tell where I'm from. You're going to know, oh, you probably weren't born in the States, because I'm teaching out of North Platte, Nebraska in the United States. So you probably, yeah, you're not from around here, are you? Well, how would you ever know? Your tongue tells where you're from. And we talked about that last week when the Ephraimites were tested by the Gileadites, if they could say the word Shelemoth. And they would say Shelemoth. They couldn't pronounce the sh sound because it would tell where they were from, even though they looked alike. So your tongue will tell where you're from. Your food, your cuisine tells where you're from. And so what do I have on the screen? Does that look good? Does that look tasty, like some tasty stew? My wife, no. And she doesn't even know what it is yet. So that is a dinuguan, Filipino pork blood stew. Totally part of the culture. So when we look at the timeline in the 21st century in their culture, they're eating pork blood stew. Go like this, go like this. So over here, I'm just going to make a little spoon, pork. I mean, we got a double whammy there, right? There's pork in it, there's blood in it, stew by the Filipinos in the 21st century. All right, so would you say that Yahweh's Torah is going to affect that culture in the area of their cuisine? 100%. 100%. In the same way in Acts chapter 15, you're not to eat anything strangled or drink blood. You cannot have, and also Torah, Leviticus chapter 11, right? You cannot have pork, blood, stew. So you're going to upset grandma when she invites you over to eat, and she has her recipe handed down through many centuries, a pork blood stew, and you say, hey, I found this ancient Near Eastern literature, and I've decided that I want to follow this man, a prophet named Yeshua HaMashiach from the East, and they think you're crazy and you've lost your mind, and you say, so I can no longer eat this pork blood stew, right? So that's going to have a dramatic effect on that. But there could be other things in their culture, maybe songs or music, that the Torah won't have any effect on whatsoever at all. that they can still keep that as part of the culture, maybe even certain ways of dress in the Filipino culture that the Torah will allow. All right? Let's look at some more. Flat Earth. I talked to some brothers about this quite a bit. There you go. You have that model. You can see where they get the flat earth, and they have all the different scriptures to show it. You can just take a minute and kind of view that there. Now, here's the situation on this, is that I've actually encountered Hebrew Israelite teachers that teach a round earth. And before you take the camera or your screen or whatever you're on, your phone, and you smash it and you get angry at me, I lean more towards a round earth. Oh my gosh, this guy teaches Torah and you're in big trouble now, right? So I lean more towards a round earth than I do a flat earth. However, I've heard Torah teachers teaching the Bible says that there's a round earth. Or I should point this way, right? The Bible says, and they'll use ones like Isaiah 40, verse 30, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 22, the circle of the earth and things like this. And they'll say that the Bible communicates a round earth. Wrong. The Bible, the literature in the Bible absolutely doesn't communicate a round earth. The ancient people believed that the earth was flat. They wrote and they communicated in a way from their understanding of a flat earth. And so in that mindset of not only just flat earth, but then you'd have waters above the earth. So they believed in a firmament that was a hard foundation that could let waters in, but it could also keep all the waters out. And it was up in the sky and it blotted, it separated the waters. So up above that, when you look up and you see a blue sky, they thought that's another ocean, basically, to put it into that terminology, that there's waters up there. And then they have the earth with the underworld underneath of the earth. And again, this is all communicated in beautiful Hebraic poetry from the understanding of the biblical authors of the day. So if I were to tell you that just because, and watch this, make this a little bigger. If I were to tell you that because the biblical authors believed the earth was flat, and so in the communication that had another point, the point was never the flat earth in their communication, but as they're telling this beautiful story, and they're going also, like, you know, into future prophecies of Yeshua, as they're rebuking and they're correcting and they're trying to get people back on track to that the culture falls in line with the Torah, and that the culture doesn't, of Israel, doesn't go by the guidelines of another law from another people, these other fallen beings. They want to bring people back to the Torah, right? The prophets. So when they're communicating and they speak according to what they know or what they understand, and they believe that the earth is flat, and this could be a shocker, but everybody, and you have this 40th century all the way up to, like, I can't even remember, I think it's like the 14th or 15th century, somewhere in there. I'd have to go back and Google it, like the time of Galileo, that they started to discover by when they would track the constellations, they would move across, they begin to discover, because they looked at the sky every night, that, hey, this earth, it doesn't seem like it's flat. It seems round, and that I can't see. And I'll go into that in a teaching all at another time, because we could dive into that for a long, long time. But when they're communicating this, everybody believed that the earth was flat. Whether you were heathens, devil worshipers, or you were of the Israelite people worshiping Yahweh, they all community believed the earth was flat. So you didn't have Yahweh dropping down on the people, hey, I want to communicate something to you. My earth is flat. We don't ever see that in all the Bible, that direct communication to the people. It's just already understood by the people already living on earth that the Torah came down to, they believe the earth was flat. That's what the Bible communicates. So it's wrong to communicate that the Bible teaches around earth, because the ancient people all believed that it was flat. Are we there? Does that believe, or does that communicate to you all, that if I say that, no, I actually lean more towards the earth is round, in the 21st century, we have satellites and things that communicate back and forth every second or every minute from the earth to show us imageries, we know that the earth, or we have a strong sense that the earth is round. Does that mean that the Bible is a lie, it's non-inspired, and it's completely fabricated? 100% not. 100% not. But people believe, because that the authors believe that the earth was flat, that they need in turn to believe the earth is flat themselves, and if they don't, they're calling the Bible non-inspired and that it's fabricated and it's a lie. And before you guys get too excited out there, I've sat in 6-hour Bible studies all about the flat earth. I mean, I have friends, close friends that I respect. They 100% believe in a flat earth, 100%. And I don't mock that. I don't make fun of that. Do I have any ship out of my land that I've flown up and I've viewed for myself the curvature of the earth or non-curvature? No, I have not. All I'm talking to you about is the ancient biblical authors and this idea that if you don't go with a flat earth perspective, because that was part of the culture, today in the 21st century, if you don't accept that, then you're calling the Bible a fable and fairy tales. And most people out there don't actually even conclude that. In the broad stream of churches, you don't have them denying Jesus in that way because they say, oh, the Bible is outdated. It teaches a flat earth. Do we see? Do we see that? Because let me tell you something, this, as some of you may be struggling a little bit. If there are things in the 21st century that we don't know, we're making new discoveries all the time, but we don't know how certain things are. So if Yahweh communicates to me in Nebraska in the 21st century and says, thus saith Yah, and he tells me, you take a pen and you write this visionary experience that I've shown you, Eric, and I want you to give it to the people. When I write that visionary experience, how am I going to do it? And I've had visions before, very, very few. And so it's surprising to me that people communicate with Yah one-on-one through a visionary experience like 3 times a day. When we don't see that in the Bible even. And we even seen all the body of the Israelite people like in Maccabees saying that there was no prophet in the land. And they had as a huge community of people, thousands and thousands, they had to wait for a prophet to come. But today you got 50 prophets in one church. Or 2 or 3 in a church. It's just amazing to me because you don't see that add up biblically that way. But I've had visionary experiences that I wrote down. How did I write it down? The way my mind thinks. Let me stop that train of thought and go over here, and I believe it's going to go together. I have read and have had many shepherd pastors, teachers, they would share with me visions that they had written down. And do you know what struck me? Is it was written in the 14th to 16th century Old English. Now, where do I think that they were influenced when they got that? From the King James Bible. So they would say that Yah was communicating to them and talking to them, and they're writing it down, and it's like, thus saith the Lord thy God, or thus saith Yahweh the Elohim, this you shall see in the days to come, that the heart of the people shall wane pale or wax pale, right? And it's all in this, it's like, but what's shocking is that individual that I know, and more than one, they don't talk like that. When they do their teachings, they're talking like me right now, but then I share a message that Yahweh gave me, and I'm reading it to you. Guys, this morning I had a vision, and I want to share it with you all right now. Here it is. Thus saith Yahweh, the hearts of the people shall wax pale, and a great horn shall rise up from the east. And you're like, and many of you wouldn't think anything about it. That should be an immediate red flag if I'd say it that way. Am I saying that that means, and that's an indicator for all of you to say that that was not divinely inspired, and that person's a liar and a false prophet? That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying this is a red flag. And that person might even have to self-evaluate why they wrote that way. And maybe they'd be like, yeah, I don't know why. I heard from Yah, but I wrote it that way. And I guess, yeah, the influence of the King James Bible on me. Do we kind of get? So if Yah was communicating to me and I'm writing, it's all because of everything that Yah has put me through and all the experiences that I had in order to communicate to you all today. I'm going to only write up into the knowledge that I have. And is Yahweh concerned about if he's calling people back to Torah, because that was a job of a prophetic speak, or, you know, the speech or writing was to bring people back to Torah. That's the main emphasis of the message. So he's not concerned about if I'm speaking and I'm talking about things coming through the heavens, flying through the earth and this and that. If I'm putting it in the ways that the words that my audience can receive them in the 21st century. The idea is to get to the heart of the message. Do we see and do we hear and understand that? Because so many people, when they hear about the ancient Israelite authors, and I talked about this before, you can bring up all kinds of accounts of the Bible, they will look at what's written and the things that happen, they'll miss the overall message that's being communicated. Like say it's all about that the overall message is that to have faith. Like Abraham going into Egypt and lying about Sarah being his niece, saying that it's his sister so that he's not killed, and it was a lack of faith that he had. But Yahweh still preserved him and brought him out of that, right? Is that to teach us? Should we get, so that's what we do when we visit a foreign group of people, that we lie about who our wives are so that they don't kill us. No. It's a message about faith and how Yahweh preserves and how our ancient men, even though that they're fathers of the faith, they were humans and they had times that they fell short, right? But Yahweh was still there for them and they never lost their faith in Yah because Yahweh never breaks his promises over his people. So even though you fall short and you stumble, get back up because Yahweh will preserve and bring you through. That's the overall message. Not that we look back at the times of Gideon and go, I know how to hear from Yah now. Oh, really? How? Yeah, you're supposed to throw out a shirt onto our grass outside. And if it has dew on the shirt in the morning, but not on the grass, then Yahweh says, yes, what I showed you is true. And if the dew's not on the shirt and it's only on the grass, then no, it's false and you shouldn't go do that. It's like a Urim and a Thummim. Do you understand what I'm communicating? Was that the point of Gideon's story? No, it wasn't. So when we see things, and we're going to get there even more so as we go forward, when people start apologetic ministries to try to answer these changes or these discrepancies in the Bible, a lot of it's not even necessary. So it says this king was 18 years old when he took over the throne in Kings, but then in Chronicles, he was only 8 years old. So is the Bible completely fabricated? It's a lie. We should throw it out. Because even when we go back to the oldest manuscripts, it says 18 in one place and 8 in the other place. If it's divinely inspired and the eyes roll back in their writing, and we even find this, you could say, well, Eric, that's Chronicles and that's Kings. Well, that was also embodied as the prophets in the days of Yeshua. Because he said that the Torah and the prophets and the Psalms spoke of me. When you study ancient Judaism, the Psalms and the prophets and the Torah comprise the Tanakh. That's how they referred to it in a three-part. That's how they referred to it. So Yeshua is saying, in the volume of the book, what's the book? The Tanakh, not the Gospels and the letters of Paul. I come to you, lo, behold, in the volume of the book. So what are you going to do when you go to Kings and Chronicles and there's all these discrepancies all over? What are you going to do when you go to Bereshit, the Genesis in the beginning, and you got Genesis 1 and 2, and there's different order of creation? Animals were created before man in 2, but man was created before animals in 1. Does it mean we throw everything? No, what was the communication in Genesis? And I'll do a teaching on that in the future, and it's beautiful. And it's the answer to, we see that the lo I come, behold, in the volume of the book that this Messiah is coming. Why does he need to come? What happened? Why is earth in the way that it is? Why, if Yah is the Elohim of life and goodness and truth and beauty and love, then why do we have hate, death, deformity, deceit, treachery, betrayal? Why do we have all of this? Go back to the answer. What happened? What took place? So when you have Bereshit, the beginning, it's the story of an Elohim that created, he had heavenly imagers, and then he created earthly imagers. And he works through people. So it shouldn't be a shock when you come to the biblical literature, and everything I said up to now shouldn't be shocking, because Yah chose to work through people. Through all our flaws, through all of who we are, he loved us and wanted to work through us. He already had betrayals of his heavenly beings too, where they fell short and betrayed him as well. We see that, right? We have the throne guardian in the beginning, in Genesis, the serpent, which according to Ezekiel, the serpentine throne guardian, not the Bible tells you who that is in the beginning, because also Lucifer, who betrayed Yahweh, who betrays the king? Who has the most influence to betray kings and to take away part of their followers? The closest people to the king, the throne guardians. So again, you're following the thoughts, right? Stick along, guys. Make notes. We're just flowing today through the Holy Spirit, okay? So when you have that in the beginning, what I'm communicating today is that if you go and read the Bible and you say, I have to take everything literally in a 21st century Western perspective. So if it says flat earth is communicated in the Bible, I got to believe flat earth today. This isn't saying that you are not debating flat and round earth. I'm just saying that you say, I have to believe flat earth, because that's what the biblical authors were talking about. And that's the way they formed certain Hebraic poetry messages. The same ones go back to Bereshit and a snake is talking and they say, snakes talked. And there's entire apologetic ministries based on things like this that go back and they spend thousands of hours trying to teach London and show how a snake, they will go like this. See what we can see, okay? They'll go, oh, we have a snake. I should have had you come up, London, and draw this because you know how you can draw snakes good. And they will say, snakes at one time had legs. They won't have, because it says that now you'll go forth on your belly and lick up the dust of the earth. And so at one time I want to show you, and some of you may out there think this now, that one time snakes had legs, and because we read about in the Bible, we have to be able to prove. Now, again, I'll have to go stop, put on the brakes. Am I arguing and debating with you today whether a snake previously had legs or not? Jersey, is that what I'm trying to do, is argue whether or not snakes have legs? I'm not. The Bible is not intended to be a biology book or a geography book or a science book. That's like taking one of your men's shotguns or women's and you go home and you have like one of your young men out like digging with it, hammering with it. And they go, well, it's a tool, right? Yeah, but that's not what that's for. You're using it for something other than what it was intended to be. So people today think they use the Bible for something other than it was intended to be. So they spend all this time arguing, do snakes have legs or not? And I feel that it is my job to prove to you that snakes at one time had legs. And if I cannot prove that snakes at one time had legs and snakes at one time could talk, then the Bible's a lie. The Bible's garbage, throw it out. You're missing the Hebraic poetry. You're missing the point. They wrote poetic format in order for you to understand. Yeshua did this all day long. When Yeshua said that we are trees or I'm the tree of life, when Yeshua said, hey, drink of my blood and eat of my body, should that be literal? Should we think that he's the literal vine and we're literally branches? Like the actual, he's trees and we should go and do tree worship? Should we do that? Should we go pray to trees? Because people did that kind of stuff all the time. All the time. No, that's not what. But you can understand that. But when I come over and I say, hey, this serpent was not that. Wrong. This serpent was actually a heavenly being, a throne guardian. And they spoke of them. They used serpent form. That doesn't mean that the throne guardian was actually in the form of the serpent. It communicates a message. And they would have, wings. I don't want to make bat wings, right? That could be a stumbling block for people. But so you'd have these heavenly throne guardians. So this was a spiritual entity that was speaking to Adam and Eve. The evil in the earth, and these are supposed to be wings, by the way. Looks ridiculous, but you get it. Flapping wings. That this is the one that defected away from Yahweh, and that this comes into the earthly realm and communicates to Yahweh's earthly imagers and deceives them and tricks them into coming into agreement to define good and evil on their terms. Any ancient member of the audience that this author was communicating to with Genesis would never have thought that that's a real snake talking. That was a clear indicator that something supernatural is taking place, that there is something not normal. Snakes just don't talk. It's getting you to pay attention. Then they know that that's just a representation, an image of this heavenly being that defected away from Yah, that was coming down now to destroy Yah's people, to get them to rebel against Yah. And because they came into agreement and got kicked out of the garden, that's why we're working under the sweat of our brow and with thorns, and there's death and there's pain and there's sadness because of this first rebellion. That's the message. And so the second part of the message is saying, hey, how is Yah going to restore Eden with these people? And there you have the gospel narrative that goes on and on and on about this love story of Yah restoring fellowship with his people. So when the ancient Israelite author got done, he didn't intend, the author, the audience collectively did not intend for Bereshit, the origin story, to be a science book of exactly how everything came into being exactly the way it should have. You got all that, right? And you had different collections. It was given orally, and they got brought together. And that's why you have a different order, because it wasn't important to them. And I'll get into that. I'm jumping ahead. We'll get into that into another week. But you're not so much smarter out there than the ancient Hebraic authors. They were actually literary geniuses, divinely inspired. And when Yahweh would put his Holy Spirit upon a person, we see, like in Exodus, where they would be able to do great works, like through the work of their hands, build beautiful structures and the homes and things for Yah, right? The tabernacle, and to design it. They were blessed. The same way literary. They're blessed with the ability to speak, to communicate, to write in a beautiful format. But when they read this, they know that in Genesis 1 to Genesis 2, the order of creation changes. That's not a surprise to them, and it wasn't a surprise to Yahweh. It wasn't what Yahweh was trying to communicate. So Yahweh didn't go, whoa, stop. You need to erase that. Back up. I really created man before animals. You've got it out of order. That wasn't important to Yah. That wasn't important to the author, and that was not important to the audience. They didn't stumble over that, but today, this will be brought up to your children, if it hasn't already, especially if they go off to colleges, it's going to be brought up to them. Or on the street, somewhere, sometime, things like Genesis will be brought up. Oh, you believe in this Bible? It's full of grammatical errors all over the place. It can't even get the creation right. So if I'm to believe that Moses, when he wrote Genesis, went like this and wrote, and that's what we have today, then is the Holy Spirit confused? Does Yahweh know the right hand from the left hand? How come Yahweh can't even get his origin right? That's not the message. That's not what's important. And so they kept all these writings collectively together, and you have them bound up today, because everything that they got and they brought in, they felt was important, like we would today, right? We feel, if we discover today some 10th century BC text, that would be enormous and beautiful, and we would love it, and we would want to preserve and accept it and bring it in. But we're going to test it on Torah, right, to see if it all goes in the guidelines. But if it had like the creation a little bit out of order, are we going to throw it away? So when it got into Genesis chapter 2 and they got that collection and they brought it in to form the Tanakh, then they go, oh, this is out of order. We need to change that. No, because they were convicted that if they changed it, that they would be cursed. They would be cursed. And so they wanted to preserve it in its natural order and bring it together, and bam, there you go. So all of that's important. Then again, that's when you have this flat earth perspective. They believed in the flat earth. The idea that when you read these verses, like you see here, and it's actually upsetting to me regardless if the earth is flat or not, regardless, right? That when you read these verses that are on this picture here, that that's what you got out of the message. Have you ever seen or been out there maybe yourselves when you teach? I know I had this happen all the time. I'll teach a beautiful message of restoration, of hope to the people, and people are crying and lives are changed. I get communications going, what you said was right on time. I was praying over this exact thing and you got up that morning and delivered it, changed my life, rekindled my faith. Beautiful. Somebody else will get on and go, you know, his name's not Yahweh. You know, his name is Yahawashi all the time. You know that Jesus is pagan. And I'm like, that's your response out of a 40-minute love letter that I wrote, gave to you? Your response is, the name of Jesus is pagan? That's what you got out of the message? The same thing people are doing with the Bible. The same thing that they're doing when you see the arguments over this flat earth. That's the, what you've got? Yahweh was not trying to communicate right there that the earth was flat. He had something completely different that he was communicating to the people, and they wrote the way that they viewed the earth. And so like I said today, if Yahweh dropped down on me, I would write according and to the limits of my understanding to communicate the central and core message that Yahweh had. If Yahweh wanted to come in and set the record straight on the formation of the earth, biology and geography and science and whatever, if he wanted to set the record straight on all of that, that would be different. And if a biblical author came out and he said, this is how, this is the way, and this is the overlining message that I needed to communicate is male and female biology. Is geography. This is what I... That's different. If that's not the point, and I'm communicating a message today, what happens if the earth is still here 2,000 years from now? There's going to be people that read it and go, oh, look at this guy's understanding. Look at how he thought the earth was. Look how he thought geography was. Look how he thought biology was. Isn't that funny? And they'll start nitpicking it and say, what this man uttered is utterly false because we found out that this town actually was built on another town and it wasn't the way he believed it at all. So the words that he heard from the Most High Yah are false and fictitious. But is it really? Is that what I was trying to communicate? Or what about the overlining message of repentance and restoration? Maybe that's what he was trying to communicate. Maybe that's what we should pay attention to. You see, I think we're all there. I think we get it. So let's just jump and keep moving. I want to show you things, changes in culture as I look at my list here. So I want to show you that in the Bible, bam, we have changes in culture within the Bible itself. So I want to show you through the Levirate law. I could do this on many things, many, many areas. I'm going to just pick a couple, right? I hope you got your favorite beverage. Okay, here we go. So in Bereshit 38:8, it says, then Yehuda said to Onan, go to your brother's wife and perform the duty of a brother-in-law to her and raise up offspring for your brother. Now, what we have there is something that was already in the culture of that ancient people, is that they had the Levirate law or Levirate law, however you want to pronounce it, and that if your brother has a wife and he didn't have a son or a daughter, because we'll learn, I did a teaching, the Levirate teaching, that talks about a daughter could carry on and have the inheritance as well. Didn't have to only be a son. But so they'd had no offspring. Then the brother of the dead brother is to go into his sister-in-law and raise up seed that his name be not blotted out of Israel. And it was for land inheritance rights. But like I showed you in the Levirate teaching, when we look at the tables of the chronology or the, when you look at the ancestry of the Israelite people leading to Yeshua, they don't record the one that died in the ancestry. So like in the time of Boaz goes into Ruth and raised up seed for and I forget the name, for her dead husband. And he's like a family member removed, you know, he's the next of kin. So he goes into Ruth to raise up seed for her dead husband for land inheritance rights. But in the ancestry, Boaz is recorded in Luke. Not the one that died. And Judah is recorded when he fulfills the Levirate vow through Tamar. Not his dead son. And I believe it was Onan, but I have to go back and you know, refamiliarize. You see what I mean? So even in that, it wasn't being carried out like it was designed to originally do. So we have in the culture, see here, I'll go like this. So we'll say back in here somewhere, Levirate law. Already going on. Already taking place, the Levirate law, right? Show you this. Deuteronomy 25:8. The Torah is going to come in and talk about the Levirate law. That is good. Yah wants it. And he says in Deuteronomy 5:8-10, then the elders of the city shall call him and speak to him. And if he, priest, persists, saying, I do not wish to take her, then his brother's wife shall go up to him in the presence of the elders and pull off his sandal, off his foot, and spit in his face. And she shall answer and say, so it shall be done to the man who does not build up his brother's house, and the name of his house shall be called in Israel the house of him who had his sandal pulled off. So is it commanded to perform the Levirate vow? It's not commanded, because there's a way out. And the way out is saying, hey, I don't want to do it. And then what are you charged to do? In Torah, take off the shoe. The woman's supposed to go over and spit in your face and say you're dishonored. You know, what was it? So we got to look at like the overall principle. What was this for? Before we get there, I'll take you here. So Ruth 4:7, what I was talking about is Ruth, her husband died. Boaz, the next of kin, comes in, fulfills the Levirate law through the writings here in Ruth to raise up seed for a land inheritance purpose. And again, at this point, we actually had land. And today, we don't have that, right? We will be restored it again. But now this was the custom in former times in Israel. So Ruth, much like a lot of the Bible, was orally passed down. Orally passed down. Here, at the time that Ruth is already taken place, it's already been passed down, but here the author decides, you know what, we should actually write this account down. And he writes the account of Ruth down, and we have that account today. And the author in, check it out, we'll go like this, the author in his century, about in here, oops, so here's the Levirate law. Here's the Levirate law going through the centuries. So we have it here, and the author's writing Ruth. I sure hope I'm not making this too confusing. But the author's writing about Ruth. He's putting it down on paper, and he communicates to his audience. Now this was the custom in former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging to confirm a transaction. The one drew off his sandal and gave it to the other, and this was the manner of attesting in Israel. So what is that automatically telling you? What is it telling you about the Deuteronomy chapter 25, Levirate law, at the time that Ruth's being written down? It's not being practiced. It's not being practiced in its original format. The Bible tells you that it's not. So this isn't Teacher Eric trying to come up with some every wind of doctrine. The Bible tells you what it is, if you would just pay attention to it. Okay? They got the purpose of the Levirate law in the time of Paul when it's speaking in 1 Timothy chapter 5 And it's saying, let a widow be enrolled into what? The service of widows and orphans. And go down to 11 of 1 Timothy 5, but refuse to enroll younger widows. Tell them to get out and start creating a family. You shouldn't be our problem. This is the Levirate law in function at the time of Paul. The widows are still being taken care of. People that lost their husbands, they're still being taken care of. But if you're a young widow and you're fertile, then get out and remarry. Why would they be coming into Paul asking about this if everyone was practicing Levirate law? They wouldn't. And Paul goes and he's pulling off of Deuteronomy 25 and Genesis, was it 38 or 35, whatever one, 38. He's pulling off of that and places like Ruth. When he says that a man that won't take care of his own house is worse than an unbeliever. If you have women that are your next of kin or women that you've extended your covering over, and they're going out and asking other men to give to their household so they have food to eat and to take care of them, doing GoFundMes or whatever that they're doing out there, and that's a dishonor to the man of that house, but if the man of that house is okay with it, he's worse than an unbeliever. Paul's saying, look, you're like as a sinner. You need to be taking care of your household. So what do we get? Does this mean that you just ignore then things like the Levirate law and the Bible and say, hey, that's for an agrarian people, which means an agricultural people of that century and of that day, and we're not an agricultural first century Israelite or 10th century BC Israelite? So then we don't need to obey any of these laws. See, that's the misunderstanding in the other direction, but we're a balanced ministry. You gotta rightfully balance the scales and know how to apply Torah in the 21st century. That doesn't diminish Torah, but fulfills the Torah. See, Jesus would talk like I'm talking. Paul would talk like I'm talking. And what did they accuse both of them of? Destroying the law. Jesus got it. That's why Yeshua had to come out and said, not one jot or one tittle will hereby be removed from this law until all be fulfilled. And when's the time of fulfillment? In the end of Revelation, when New Jerusalem's brought down and Yahweh says, I'm the Alpha and the Omega, and it is finished. That's when the time of completion. We're not there yet. We're a long way off. So then people go, well, do you bring in goats and rams? Paul dealt with the same thing. He talks all about it in Hebrews, which I believe he's the author of Hebrews, or somebody directly under Paul wrote Hebrews, because it speaks in the manner that Paul speaks. And he tells about why we don't do sacrifices today. He talks about why we don't have the Levitical high priest system today. He tells you how it doesn't break biblical record to have a high priest out of the tribe of Judah today. Because that would have been a struggle for people. Because they're going to the law. And he says, no, you're missing the underlining message of what the gospel is communicating or what the Tanakh is communicating. That's why Yeshua said, the Tanakh spoke of me. Do you believe that the ancient people, when they read the Tanakh, the Old Testament, that they got Yeshua, his redemption and restoration, that he would have to die and be buried for our transgressions and resurrected again on the third day in order to bring forth a restoration, and that we would have to die in him and be resurrected according to his death, burial, and resurrection ourselves in the spiritual? I hope a lot of you out there don't take that literal and start drinking laced Kool-Aid as some have done. I hope that handling serpents in the Bible that you don't take as literal and say, well, did not Paul get bit by a serpent and survive? So that's speaking that we are snake handlers today, because that's what they do in churches today, is snake handle. And no Israelite got that from that message. They got it as in when John was speaking and Jesus was speaking to the Pharisee people, and he says, oh, you brood, you pack of vipers, you pack of serpents. You're of your father, the devil. He was a murderer from the beginning. What imagery do we see from the beginning? A serpent that was the betrayer. So you're like your father. You're in the image of a serpent. That's the image that Adam took on when he obeyed Satan's voice and not Yahweh's voice. So there would be one that will come where Adam failed and all of our people failed, that will be the perfect imager of Yahweh. And we're all waiting for that one. And the whole Bible will speak of him to bring forth restoration. Do you think that they all got that clearly from reading the Tanakh? No way. They had it in portions. But Yeshua had to open their mind to the scriptures in order that they would understand the gospel as recorded in Acts chapter 1 and recorded throughout all the gospels when he would speak in parables and he would quote prophets and explain the meaning of what the prophet Isaiah or whatever prophet that he chose at the time was communicating to the people. He says, this is actually the proper interpretation of what's being said here. And the Pharisees hated him for it. And the disciples' minds are blown. Okay? So, Levirate law is actually, no one's breaking Torah. It's actually being kept, but it's not being kept exactly like what we read about in the beginning. Okay? And that's, the Bible tells you that. So, yeah, look what we see here. What do you see? And don't say geeks and nerds, like some of you probably want to say, because some of you on there maybe do that. But people dress up for comics. This is Star Wars. Good job, guys. Wow, you knew one. I can't believe you got it. I don't even know. So we got Star Wars here. Now, these are people that they watch the movie, they read the books, it inspires them. And oh my gosh, like they actually have... I don't know how I got on one time, but I was just so curious. People were arguing the origin stories of Star Wars and what, who wrote, Steven Spielberg, I think, or something? Or George Lucas. George Lucas. So anyway, what he actually intended. It's so funny. And Lucas, like, he was saying, like, he just gets really entertained that people are telling him what he meant when he wrote the script or the book for Star Wars. You know, like, no, Lucas, your definition's not right. They know more than the author. What do people do today about the Bible? We know more. We've written books on the Adam and Eve origin stories and the book of John. We have all these extra biblical works that come up and try to fill in the gaps and answer these things. So they get involved in this. They form communities around these things like Star Wars and Harry Potter, whatever. And then they go into and have debates over why somebody did a certain thing, over who was whose family member, right? They do all this stuff. They dress up like the characters. Some of them who are just hyper involved, you go and they get tattoos of the witches on them. You go to their houses. They have like signs and pictures up all over their homes of Star Wars, action figures, whatever. They dress like them on a day-to-day basis, Star Wars t-shirts, and they live and breathe and eat it. They're Star Wars for life. That's their culture. Okay, Star Wars had an effect on their culture. Here's a Comic-Con. We see this. So people go to these Comic-Cons. Some are dressed up. You can see right there. Some are not dressed up. But they're there for the same thing. One mind, one body. They're all there for the same thing, right? So what am I talking about? Well, why am I showing you all this? Because when you read the Bible and you get inspired, like we all should, and we read about this ancient people, and they become our heroes. We admire them. We want to emulate and be like them at their best, right? We don't want to be like David at his worst or Abraham at his worst, because we're all humans and we read about them at their worst in the Bible. We want to be like them at their best. Well, who was like them at their best at all times? Yeshua. So who should we emulate and copy? Yeshua. His principles and how we treat and love one another. But people will read about this ancient people and they will read about how Torah comes in and has a dramatic effect on the culture that they were already living when Torah drops on them and says, hey, I'm going to change your culture. I'm going to alter and reshape. Because what about the people that left Torah, went into captivity, came back to Torah? Mind blow, total shift of culture. What about us today when we're living our lives and we find Torah to serve Yeshua? Total wrecking ball to our culture. But then when we read about this people and we see other things in their culture, we want to start to dress like the ancient people, just like we see people do here. We want to refashion our lives around them. As I brought up before, the Amish are one of the biggest examples. Go back to community living like them. Go back to no electricity like them. Go up, English is a pagan heathen language. I want to divest myself of my current culture, everything in it, and make up a new language. Make up new music. Make up new this and new story, new that. A dress code that we're all alike. Is what I have on in front of you right now a sin to wear against this? Absolutely not. Now, this doesn't say Nike or have a Nike emblem on it, because Nike is a foreign pagan goddess of victory. That's her name. And I'm not going to have some other god on my clothing. I don't want that, because gods created emblems and imagery in order to have dominion in geographical, earthy locations spiritually. And that was a whole lot. You need to go back and watch all my teachings on angels. Are they like earthly men or heavenly beings? I have it all on my website, my YouTube. I got the playlist. Going to giants. I explain all of this type of stuff. Okay? So that gives them legal ground. I don't want a god to have legal ground on me. So, but if the only shoes that you have to wear are Nikes and you can't afford other shoes, well, first off, reach out to me. Okay? Secondly, no, I don't expect you to go around barefooted. I would bind and rebuke that God has no power and that you're aware of what that God's trying to do, and you rebuke, bind, and stop that immediately. But that doesn't mean to go forward then and just say, oh, I'll do that on every Nike apparel. I like the design of the shirt, so I'm just going to rebuke the Nike. Okay, right? We know the balance. But this isn't pagan. Some of you out there may think it is pagan. But is this type of material, is this type of garment, was what was worn in the early 10th century BC, 3rd century BC, 1st century BC, 14th century AD? All knows. All knows. 19th century AD. Nope. No, not like this. So, but there are some that say, look, I want to divest myself of this and wear a tunic all the time because that's more in line with what the ancient Hebrew people were wearing. That's fine if you want to do it. Well, what I've seen time and time again, what happens is as ministries build and grow around something like that, because somebody thinks that somebody else has some special little niche, or you look out and you can admire a church group that all the people look like that, they're all dressed like that, and that's the way they're living life. Like, people want to go visit Amish communities in droves. They actually have it set up where you can go visit Amish communities, and they cater to that because people want to go in and visit it. But what if the Amish, what if they believe that what you're doing is sinful, that you're not going into the kingdom if you don't live life the way that they live life? They just don't tell you that because they're taking your money, because you're the Gentiles. But what about if I teach, if that Amish community you visited, if you don't live like that, tomorrow you're in sin against the Most High, you will not go into his kingdom. Now I'm putting a burden on you that's completely unnecessary. Totally unnecessary. So there's the confusion. Like, when we read the Bible, we admire it. We love, we fall in love with it. We want to bring it forth. And I think it's really cool. I'll wear things with tassels on it. I'll wear tunics. You've seen me in them. I love a lot of the ancient Hebraic culture and things. I will say certain words that they say, like shalom, and just, you know, I like it because I can say hi or hello. There's nothing satanic about that whatsoever at all. Or you can say shalom. But then if I tell you hello satanic, I say, oh, the word hell's in it. Well, hello, alo, actually comes from a root Hebraic word when you go and study it. And it was a greeting. So it's not satanic to greet somebody in kindness, is it? That's what hello. And then it got into popularity. It was actually a maritime greeting for mariners, on the sailors. Then it transitioned over when the invention of the telephone came into being. That's how people would greet each other on the telephone. That's where, and then it got into everyday culture on the street. So you can see you get it? So things change and things and culturally shift. So you have to go back and see, hey, with what I'm wearing now, if it was, so say that you had a woman up here and her cleavage was hanging out. And you can see her breast. In our 21st century culture in the United States of America, does Torah have a problem with that? I would say some are like, I would say yeah, because we all kind of know that if you can see a lot of a woman's revealing, that that's non-modesty. Okay? So we have the concept and ideas, but before I jump too far ahead in my thoughts, here we go here. Torah dress code. Deuteronomy 22, verse 5. A woman shall not wear a man's garment, nor shall a man put on a woman's cloak. For whosoever does these things is an abomination to Yahweh, your Elohim. So, when I read this, I'll go like that. You have to look at what culture you are in, and that law should have a dramatic effect on whatever culture you're in. But what is a misstep is to go back and read when this law was given to the ancient Hebraic people and study what their dress was like and say that's the way that law must communicate to us today. The only way that you could achieve that is to go back and dress like the ancient first century Israelite. And that's what some have chosen to do. But do you know what I find very interesting? Is so many of these communities that single out the women and require them through a personal conviction, because that conviction led to a blessing in the relationship that they have with Yeshua, then they try to impose that conviction on everybody else as a manner of community Torah. They require the woman and the woman alone to dress like a first century Israelite. But then the men wear Under Armour, wear jeans, boots, whatever they want. You don't see them at all dressing like a first century Israelite, except once a week, maybe on Shabbat. But then the woman is called whorish, Jezebel, rebellious, of the world. You see the lack of balance? So at least I can... Hey, Amish guys out there, I know you're not watching this, but you men do so likewise. You all dress alike and you have dress codes for the men as well as the women. But you can see even in the Amish, there is a 20th to 21st century twist on it. They're not wearing around ancient Israelite tunics. They have jeans, like these pants kind of a thing with suspenders and a white shirt, all the same colors, all the same shoes, women with little bonnets on their heads as a head covering. So a little bit of a difference is, because we want to go around with a veil on like we've seen in the Hebraic culture. Because head coverings aren't commanded in Torah. That might be a mind blow to people. There's no law against a woman having to wear a head covering whatsoever at all. This is not there. Do I personally like head coverings? I do. The women in my home wear head coverings all the time, not just when they're praying or prophesying, all the time. Does the head coverings that they have on look different than a first century head covering? Oh, I'm sure. Do the head coverings of people who cover their heads today, women in churches, do they differ? Yeah, some little caps, some bands, some full coverings, some only their eyes showing, some just their face showing, right? It differs. It's all there, but they're all doing the same principle of the culture. It's beautiful, and I find it to be, in my personal opinion, beautiful. So when we read here that a woman should not wear things that pertain to a man, and a man should not wear things that pertain to a woman, so a woman should not wear men's clothes, and a man should not wear women's clothes, or any symbols or anything that would communicate a different gender. And so when you go back and you study the Hebraic culture, and they're all wearing tunics, boy, that kind of looks like a dress today, but they had a woman's cloak, a woman's tunic, a woman's outward garment, overgarment, and they had a man's overgarment. They would communicate differently. When? Then. Not today. You guys wouldn't know today, right? Watch. I'll show you some more. Look at this. In this culture, I'll blow it out so you can see it all the way. This is the Kayan tribe of northern Thailand, and the women here are quite popular for wearing neck rings. So, When we read this, should the Torah forbid the neck rings? Should Torah forbid that? What's Torah's effect on that? I can't find anything in Torah. I mean, you could say, oh, that's destroying the body. That's destroying the temple of Yahweh. He created your neck at the length that he wanted it. But in their culture, that's beautiful. In their culture, that's beautifying. You see? That's not destroying the body in their culture. So I would not conclude, if I'm a missionary taking the gospel message, I'm a missionary right now, this is the mission, right? And so I'm out there communicating to this culture, because you can say, Eric, what effect is it? Well, when you're preaching to someone like this, and it may one day happen, do you tell them, stop wearing those neck rings? I see no reason to tell them that. None. Now, if a man had on those neck rings in that culture, should the man, according to Torah, even if the culture would tolerate it, I just said something huge, even if the culture would tolerate it, should a man wear those neck rings according to Torah in that culture in the 21st century here today? No. Why? In that culture, those neck rings pertain only to women. So maybe that culture would tolerate it and say, yeah, we got some funny little limp-wristed and feminine guys in our tribe, and they like to put on the feminine neck rings. Whatever. That's those guys, right? But they tolerate it. They don't put them to death or whatever. What do we have in America today? Homosexuality. What did Yahweh do? We're going to get there. So think that in your mind. I don't want to jump too much ahead, but think about what I said, if the culture will tolerate it or not, right? So yes, man, according to Torah, would have to remove those neck rings if they came to Yeshua HaMashiach. But the Torah influences and alters culture. Torah does not have a culture of its own. So it would be wrong for me to go to this tribe and say, remove everyone your neck rings, and here, let my wife pass out tunics. Here's your male tunics. Here's your female tunics. Here's your sandals. Could you imagine if we're going up into Antarctica, or is that down? That's up. Is that? Oh, wait, but if there's, depends if it's a flood. So anyway, if you're going to Antarctica and you're preaching and I've said, you have to wear sandals. It's law. We can see you got to get into the dress or you're of the world. And you guys are like, Eric, but what do you do today if a woman wears jeans and she needs to for a specific task that she's doing? I mean, there's many women. I've had lots of women, maybe in your little personal house, you don't have any job that would require one. I've had women that have gone to the gym that have gotten in close calls with their dresses being caught in machine equipment that could cause a serious injury, because they're wearing dresses in the gym working out. Because they say that God, Yahweh, Yahweh, commands the woman to wear a dress. Untrue. You will not find that anywhere in here, in the Torah, in the commandments. Not there. Not there. Now, if only women in your culture wore dresses, and that's all they wore, you could make a play there. Rephrase that. If that's technically right, but if women in our culture, it was forbidden for them, it was only for men to wear pants or sweatpants or capris or whatever, you could make that play and say, then you're wearing something that pertains to a man where you dwell in your culture. But does our culture say that? Absolutely not. In fact, there's feminine jeans, feminine capris, feminine whatever they're called, that if I wore them, you would be rebuking me immediately. Like, if a man wore them, you'd say, why does that man, and men do wear these things, have women jeans on? Right? You can tell women jeans, women pants. We see these homosexuals wearing them all the time. So I would tell, yeah, or the men were just, so I would say, why are you putting this unnecessary? If you want to wear a dress in the gym, by all means, do it. But to have the idea that it's commanded, you're mistaken what the Bible's saying. You're going with the same idea that a literal snake was talking into the garden, and now we got to accept that snakes one day, one time had legs, and at one time they would talk, and and we get into a weird side argument that has nothing to do with what the Bible was trying to communicate. Let's keep moving. What about this? So if we were going over to Scotland, the Scottish, we're in Scotland. So you see these men wearing kilts. Well, what would a child say if they saw that? No, they're dresses, right? They're wearing dresses. Well, these are the Scotland Highland dress that's worn by men and is called a kilt. Would Torah command them to take it off? Because if we're going to command women in the United States, geographically located and scattered to that part of the earth, to take off pants that were clearly designed and made for them in this culture, and maybe they need to actually wear them according to what task they are performing, and you say that they're in sin, then you would have to, if you're preaching to a Highland Scottish man, that he needs to remove that, he's wearing a dress. You're trying to take his culture and remove it and give him your own personal culture or another culture that's not of his own. Now, Torah definitely needs to come in and regulate what's going on there. So we would say, why are you wearing that? Well, the men in our culture wear these. They are called a kilt. Oh, well, totally fine. But if a woman put on in that kind of an outfit, she would need to be rebuked and corrected that you're wearing something that pertains to a man in that culture. Okay? What about this one? Those look awful similar, do they not? What's the Torah effect there? Hey, man, you need to get that off and get on blue jeans and some Carhartts? No, why would you? No, but Torah's going to come in and say, okay, clearly we can tell, like just by looking at the image that's presented to us and basing it off of this image alone, that the woman has more of a colorful garment, and you can see it shape and fashion in a different way. That the man has, like, it looks like kind of a different waist garment, an overcoat there that the woman doesn't have. And even on the other picture I put, you can see the differences, all right? So you would have to go and do what? Actually take the time to learn their culture when you preach and teach them. What does the army do when they send people overseas or they send diplomats across country or, you know, across different countries and across the seas? Learn the culture, learn how to communicate. That's why you see presidents wearing the culture's clothing when they go over to have meetings with these other government officials. And there are women dressing like that culture. You have reporters that have gotten beat and abused when they went to cultures where the women were to have their heads fully covered and only the face showing. And the reporter's like, no, I'm going to just let it all hang out. And what happened? Tragedy. So you dress as a reporter according to the culture, and you got the full head covering on, covering everything but your face. And that's how you're doing your Middle East news coverage. But just because the Bible was an Eastern book given to that people in a certain a dysphoria of time, and you can view the way they dress, does that mean that it's commanded for you today? No. But does it mean that Torah is going to have no effect on the way that you dress today? No. Torah absolutely will bring a wrecking ball to the way that a lot of people dress today. Okay? There you got the Israelite man's tunic. But do we see people in the Israelite wearing this? Some at times when they're preaching, but not when they go to work. That's not their everyday garment. I want to show you a fashion timeline. Look, just real quick. You can see through the Chinese culture, look at the changes. Look at the changes from the 3rd century AD to the 20th century AD. Look at the 21st century AD. AD and the changes. Pretty dramatic, right? But yet, no Torah violation if that's part of their culture. I think we got it. I'll stop there on talking about the dress, right? Because I get that question a lot. Is it forbidden? I'm going to go climb the side of a mountain with my husband, and it's what we do for joy, but I'm wearing a dress. And I got an undergarment, but it could get caught in the pulley and I could fall to my death. Do I have to wear the dress? I actually had that very question. I'm like, you wear the appropriate gear. But, and I'll say this, in whatever culture you are in on the other side of this camera, you know what is modest and ill-modest. Unmodesty, right? Dismodesty, whatever you call it. You know the difference. In our culture here, we know that if your breasts are hanging out and you're wearing these high shorts that show all your legs and advertising I'm for sale with your body, you're a walking billboard, okay, of a horse woman, that's communicating not modesty, right? They covering up and being covered so you're not showing all your goods to people would be more of a modest dress. You know what is modest. And yes, like in our assembly, we have definitions of modesty. Like, we don't want your cleavage hanging out. And the women will talk to you. If your shoulder's showing, if you're lusting over a shoulder, you have other problems to worry about. You know, if you see the calf of a woman, the calf on her leg, and that causes you to sin and stumble, you got some things to work through. But we have our own personal convictions of what, when we would see you, that if you didn't get it the first time around and you showed up again and you were dressed a certain way, the women are going to talk to you because you can look around and see how people are dressed. Now, that, not all the time, because some household may have a different personal conviction, right? And the women could be dressed a little bit differently, but you get the just idea. But we're not going to let women with their breasts hang around out run around like that here, but we're not going to go to you at Walmart and catch you there publicly and rebuke you there. Do what you want out in your own house, in your own place. We're talking about if you come here to a feast or a gathering or a Shabbat, that type of thing. So you all know the difference, because there's some cultures out there today, if you're doing a missions trip, that the women have their breasts hanging out, but they have a loincloth, and the men have a loincloth. So should I preach the gospel to them and command and demand that they cover their breasts? Why would I do that when that's not part of that's their culture, the culture there. So I'm offended. Why? Because of my culture. Torah doesn't talk about, you know what I mean? Now you can get into things where when the men crossed over up into the altar, the holies of Yah, their loins were to be covered. Underneath, they had to wear underwear. So what does that tell you? When they weren't crossing over, they didn't have underwear on because it's freaking hot in the desert. They didn't have their genitalia hanging out because that was not part of their culture. They were covered in a tunic like you saw, but they didn't have any underwear on underneath. But they're told at times when to have underwear on, right? So would you expect to see the breast at some time throughout the cultural period being covered? Yes, you would expect that. But I've heard about Christian missionaries going over demanding day one, start covering yourself, you're in sin. None of them are looking and gawking at that. You are. That's your personal problem. See? So it's all relevant to today. You can't live in your little box, develop your own personal laws and guidelines for your land, expect everyone to be obedient to it, and be selfish. Because what are we supposed to do with the gospel? Keep it for ourselves and let no one come in? No, that's what the Pharisees did, and that spirit's here today. It's to bring the gospel message out to the four corners of the earth. So you're going to be talking to people of all different cultures. All right? All right. Andrew, you can see this. You can see here from the 10th century, 11th century, all the way to the 21st century, how the dress changed. Well, what culture do we pick to say you have to dress like that? Right? Okay. Now, let's go into something else. We have this. We have a woman here. She's a Tibetan Buddhist called the Mansuo. Okay? They have no fathers for their children. There's no marriage. Women are the head of the family, and children are primarily raised by them, with the fathers being no more than sperm donors. Would Torah drastically alter that? In this culture, the men are simply sperm donors. They do not raise or rear children. They don't really influence the children. The women are in charge. It's a matriarchal society. They rule in their society. And they don't even get, they can have as many sexual partners as they seem fit, or as few as they seem fit. They don't go into marriage covenants. They use the men just to create offspring, but the women rule. So if I'm going over and preaching to this culture, would Torah dramatically correct that? Oh, absolutely. But in the 21st century Western culture, the answer would be no. We're modernized. Women are in the equal level playing field as men. And in fact, women can be the head of households and lead men according to Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's the point. These are people that claim Bible and say that women can rule their household. And you see them do it. Oh, God, you have Torah observant women that get on these social media platforms and they're married and they're out griping and complaining over the order of their home, over the biblical understanding that their head has placed over them in their home, questioning their head publicly. I get it all the time. Do you think this and do you think that? I'm like, are you married? Yes. Tell your husband to email me. It's ridiculous. So they believe that they are the heads of their home through a false humility of subjection to their husbands that doesn't exist. Because they're going behind their husbands' backs. Let me show you. Genesis chapter 2:18. This is how you rightfully divide the word of truth. So when you're dealing with cultural things like I brought up today, you would go to the Torah, right? And you would see. Then Yahweh said, it is not good that I make man, that the man should be alone. I will make a helper fit for him. So what's the woman that he's about to create supposed to be? A helper. And then what they'll do is people will say, well, a woman, her being in subjection to the man and the man would rule over her did not occur until the disobedience and the fall in the garden. So Yahweh did not intentionally design marriage to be like that. Marriage became that through disobedience. But prior to that, they were to co-rule jointly together under an equal authority. That's what's being presented. But that's not the case. Now, Jackson, I want you to see this. Because it just said there, before the fall, a helper. Genesis 2:19. Now out of the ground, Yahweh Elohim had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man, so Adam the man, to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was his name. So who named all the living creatures? The man, the first man did. Not Adam humankind, the first man in context here did. Named all the living creatures. So does that not show you that whatever you name is that which you have authority over? I mean, who names children? Today they would say you let the child decide. When the biological male is born, he has the opportunity to decide if he wants to be a male or not. If he chooses for himself to become a female, that is his personal choice and decision. And any way to coerce him to be a male because he's biologically a male with male genitalia is child abuse. It's already that way in Canada, and it's making its way here into our culture. So when we see that effect on culture, Torah is going to have something to say about that, is it not? And we go back to creation. What's the binary concepts of humanity? Male and female. That's what we have. Divine order. What is biblical marriage? We see that brought up a lot. What is biblical marriage? Man, woman, two binary opposites coming together to form one, biblical marriage. Polygyny was happening, multiple wives in culture, but it is a unbiblical term to define biblical marriage as a man having more than one wife. Because biblical marriage is a man and woman coming together, not a man and man coming together. And to prove that that is not the way, Yahweh blesses life on the one union, life comes from it. On the other union, death comes from it. Male or male, or female and female. So when we see all of this unity brought forth, then the man, in the when they join together and have offspring, who names the children? The man names the children. That's the way it was in our household. Oh, the woman came up with many different possibilities and suggestions, but then it was in the end my final decision, right? So I would sign off and say, this is the, I like that name. Yes, this is the name. Okay? Showing that we have authority over our children, ownership, even in our culture and society. Then when we go over to Genesis 2:23, the man said that at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. So who named woman? The man did. Showing headship and authority over the woman by naming her just as he did the beast of the field because he had that dominion. But does that mean that woman is as a beast of the field? No, because it says right here that she was taken out of my flesh. She is bone of my bones. And in what image was Adam created? In the image of Yah. It's simple, really. It's simple. So when you go and you talk to that culture, the Tibetan Buddhist of the Mansuno, and they want to come to Messiah, and there's actually women joining this culture. I read on it that women that were born with, that because in the Chinese culture, like men are a lot of the heads of their homes. Men are the heads of their homes. And so they want to get out from that. And there's a subculture. Keyword, subculture of the culture, a subculture. And in that culture, the women are the head, and these women are joining that culture because they want to be a part of that. So if one of those women come to Christ, come to Messiah, can they operate in that manner? No. Why? We can take them back to Torah and show them that the woman is a helper under the man, that the man leads and guards the home. Why? Because Yahweh ordained in creation that way. He created it that way. So it doesn't matter what culture you're in. Okay. Homes. Are we going to read about the ancient homes and go back and say that we need to live in those type of homes? And what I'm really trying to beat into people is you see a lot of these Israelite communities and places that they teach a culture restoration, that it, I am sent to restore the culture, and if Yah sent you to do that and you've had your own private revelation, so be it. I'm not going to get between you and Yah. But when they're charged this, it's so interesting how they pick and choose what part of this ancient culture on the timeline, and we're going to go right here, they pick what part of that culture they want. If the men don't want to dress like this culture, the men don't have to. If they want the women to dress like that culture, they have to. If they want to say that you can't have certain modern conveniences, that, you know, that this and this and this is unlawful in that culture, but yet they have internet, they have modern vehicles, why don't they have like the old carts with oxes pulling it? If you're sent to restore if you say, I'm sent to restore biblical marriage and biblical culture, and so multiple wives is commanded, or that means you are a superior Israelite if you have more than one wife, and you are better obeying the Bible, and you have a closer relationship with Yahweh because you have multiple wives, and you are the poster child of the Israelite culture, but yet you drive a 21st century vehicle. that or you live in a modern house, or you have electricity and Wi-Fi signal, or you have modern clothing, and you rebuke, then you cherry pick and you rebuke other people on what clothes they're wearing, on what kind of head covering they've got, on this and on that, because they don't copy and mirror you. They don't image you. Well, who was the perfect image of Yah? Messiah. So who are we supposed to image? Messiah. Did Messiah ever communicate that this is the clothing, Israel, you need to wear throughout all your generations? That this is how you pull your buggy, or this is how you transport your material, or this is how you work and plow your fields for all generations? No. Combines are unlawful. The ditch witch is unlawful. And I'll let those of you out there go, ditch witch? What kind of an abomination is that? Go look it up. Do we come to these things? But then in other areas, so you either do it or you don't, man. And again, you could pick on the Amish and go, man, they're doing it better than anybody else I've seen out there, going back to the ancient here way of life. But then look at their dress. And they're not wearing those tunics around that I showed you. They're wearing the modern tunic that they've all agreed upon. Okay? Now, if you want to be part of one of these ministries or these communities or these whatever you want to call it, movements, your prerogative. Is it unlawful for you not to use a tractor today? For you to use an ox pulling the plow? And the plow was like when they would do plows and they would create these little rows, this would be a little plowshare. And you'd be going along, and that's how come it says that one that puts his hand to the plow and looks back is worse or is unfit for the kingdom, because you get off course. And if you would look back, you would start to make wrong lines, and you would look at your journey, and it would be all over the place, swayed. And your doctrine to Messiah shouldn't be like that. Your walk in Christ should be on the straight and narrow, right, as he forms and molds you. Now, if I went back and plowed my field with oxes and asses, donkeys, and these type of things, and using that ancient plowshares, would that give me a better biblical understanding to parables that Yeshua communicated to that first century agrarian people, agricultural people? Absolutely. As I'd be doing it, I'd be like, wow. Mind blown. I totally get. So how can we obtain that today? We can study the culture. I just communicated it to you and gave you understanding of it. How did I get it? Right? Study, listen, view. But does it mean you have to actually live that way? It doesn't. But you can make the argument, but do you have a better understanding from living this way? Yeah. So then if you choose, you know what? I'm just going to adopt that lifestyle, because it's more quiet, it's more back to the biblical people. I just want to do it. Fine, great. I may adopt a lot of the things you do by watching you. I may want to visit your place a heck of a lot because I think it's pretty cool. I may use videos and things that you put up to show people how cool I think you are. But as soon as I hear out of your lips any rebuke, any disdain, any high-mindedness out of you, out to other people that aren't doing what you're doing, and you're discrediting those people, that's where I've got a problem and where I got to draw the line and say, you're out of order. And we can get into living in cities. Where's that? You're commanded to come out of the cities. I showed you a few weeks ago that Abraham told Lot, you choose this side or that side. Whatever you want, you have, I'll take the opposite. So Abraham could have ended up over by Sodom and Gomorrah just as easily as Lot ended up over there. Just as easily. He said, which side do you want? But if you behave like Lot's wife and you integrate into the culture and divest yourself of the culture or in the Torah of Yahweh, and you don't allow the Torah of Yah to come into the culture in Sodom and Gomorrah and to re-evaluate your life and to change and to alter it, you put that aside to join their culture, what's going to happen? You'll be consumed in their sins. So all I could say, it's a great idea to get out of the cities. How do we even define city? By whatever pastor's preaching it, I guess. Because what population density does it have to achieve in order to meet your definition of city? I would say if the biggest place in your town is the local Walmart, you're not living in a city. If you're walking down and you got all these graphics and buildings and you got to pass people on the street like that, you're living in a city, right? That's my definition. So can you be in the city and allow Torah in the city, in the culture of the 21st century, and the culture of your geographical location, then in the subculture of the city, because in that geographical location, in that time frame, you're going to have a different culture in the city versus the country. Fast-paced life, slow-paced life, right? Different priorities, right? True. Subcultures. So if you are the one in the city, can Torah guide you in that city to be a light to the people in that city? 100,000%. Would I suggest if you're in a city where you pass people on the street like that, and sirens and horns and blah, it's going off all day and night, millions and millions of people, I would suggest you get out of that. Because there's a lot of evil going on there, and it's a lot quieter out like where we live in the country. And in fact, in Nebraska where we live, I really like this area. Know why Yahweh has me here? Because it's insulated from the coast. We're in a flyover state, is what they would call it. I've talked to people on all kinds of military backgrounds that know we live in a great area. Great protected area. Don't have to worry about military invasion there, do you? They would comment all the time about where we live. In business, we're protected from the craziness of the cultures. I shouldn't say, they'll bring my whole stream down. That thing that just went around that made people put things on, that thing, we were protected from that here. We weren't putting those things on really here, hardly at all, huh? Where they were wearing them and are still wearing them all over. I sell and work with places by the interstate, Interstate 80. People are coming from all different cultures through there and subcultures, and they're all wearing those. Still, I'm like, oh God, that's still going around? I forgot all about that. You see what I mean? So yes, Yahweh can work with you in the city, and no, you're not in sin if you're in the city, but is it a good idea to come out? Yep. But people will teach if you're in the city, you're of the world, and you're in sin, and they're missing. We're an agricultural people. We're an agricultural people. I got something to tell you. Get a pen. Get ready to write this down. For those of you that say, we are an agricultural people, we are this people, I have something revolutionary for you. The Bible was written for you, absolutely. However, any of you watching this right now, the Bible was not written to you. Write that down. Remember it as you read. It was not written to you. It was written to an audience that these authors had to communicate to and that they could receive and understand it. If I have a vision of this calamity coming in through the air and I see these things flying by, maybe I see jet-propelled planes, stealth bombers, helicopters, Apache helicopter, whatever, right, going through the air, shooting missiles, blowing up geographical, wow, man, right? And I come to, and Yahweh says, write this down and tell my people of what's to come. What am I going to do? Yahweh, okay, communicate to me, Yahweh, through divine inspiration. What did I see? Well, you saw a stealth bomber, jet, F-15 fighter, whatever, right? And okay, so now what was coming in the back? Fire, how does it go through? And Yahweh was sitting there for 3 days teaching me about aerodynamics and jet propulsion. And once I'm able to maybe even handle that, now I got to know what those things that shoot out and cause big bombs or big explosions of fire. Those meteorites? What? No, those weren't meteorites. Those were these missiles. Well, what's in the missile? What causes? Yahweh's like, Isaiah, stop. That is not what I'm trying to tell you. What I'm trying to tell you is that the people don't turn their heart backs to me through my Torah and follow the banner that I raise up for the nations, whom is Yeshua HaMashiach. And they don't allow me to influence and to refashion and alter their culture and to come out and take on my law, statutes, and commandments in order to serve and to define good and evil by my terms instead of in their heart according to their own terms. If they don't do that, judgment will come. And just like I used people in the beginning to rule and to create life, go forth and multiply, he told Adam and Eve, the king and the queen. I will use people to bring judgment, like I always have, through the Assyrians, through the Amorites, through the Moabites, through the Canaanites. I will use them to chastise you, Israel, to bring you back into obedience. That's what I'm talking about. Restoration, that's the content of the message. You don't need to know what those things are up in the sky. Got it. So what is Jeremiah, Isaiah, Ezekiel write? A chariot was drawn through the sky. He came in on a flaming horse, right? A meteor came down onto this. You see? So that the audience, because if Yahweh is trying to get them into a 21st century Israelite perspective, modern human perspective, way back in the 20th century BC, in order to communicate to the people, even if the author has divine revelation, think what a mess the people are going to be in. The people couldn't even understand and comprehend and come back into obedience when they were seeing chariots flying through the sky. Could you imagine trying to explain jet propulsion and rockets and, you see? So there we have, I pray that you're getting where the Bible was written for us. Can we read about chariots and everything and then modernize it into our modern times and equate it into our times and bring forth revelation in our times? Yes, the Bible goes for all time and centuries. It's a beautiful work of literature that way. And I do believe that's why a lot of it was written in Hebraic parallelism poetry and why a lot of parables were communicated. Just like when Yeshua, like I said before, was speaking in a parable, he may do it different to somebody in our Ontario, Canada, working in IT. Right? He may have a different, if he was talking about, well, you know, when someone scatters seed and he'd be like, I have never even so much as planted a bean plant. I don't even have herbs growing in my kitchen or on my balcony. You know what I mean? I have no idea. So he'd have to communicate to them in their culture, subculture, and their perspective. And that's what we have. So when we go back then and we read about these, I'll point this way. When we read about this and the way that they lived, do we go and form our houses like that? You see that many people don't. Some do. I've talked to people that went and they moved and lived in tents. Why? Because I read about it in our culture and I'm restoring the ancient Israelite people. Our people lived in tents, but you can see the transition of culture where they actually lived in cities. Levitical priests had homes in cities that would not be lost during the Jubilees. So there you have that, right? How about where Yeshua was from? Galilee, millions of people. Anyway, it's all through there. So check this out. If you guys are angry and you're grumbling at me and you think that I'm missing it and that, no, we're supposed to do everything we read in the Bible, whatever the first century Israelite, their perspective, if it's in Torah, you're commanded to do it. Even though we can see with just one of the examples, like the Levirate law, that they already weren't keeping that. Why? Because the culture didn't require it any longer. So through the captivities and dispersions, culture, the Hebraic people no longer required the Levirate law practice in the original way. It didn't require it. But Yahweh said in Deuteronomy, as long as that is your cultural way, I'm going to come in and touch into this culture and say, you obey it that way. But when no one's offended and no one's angry or upset, you're good to go. So it can be practiced in many ways. But Yahweh said, no, you still will take care of the homeless and the widow whose husband dies and this. So Paul set up places like this, the early first church. You have Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 4, same principle, same sharing taking place, right? Deuteronomy 22:8. So when you build a new house, you shall make a parapet for your roof that you may not bring the guilt of blood upon your house if anyone should fall from it. There is a Torah commandment that you must have a parapet on your house. So how many people that have ministries that say that they are charged to restore the culture to the people, and if you don't live like an early first century BC or third century or first century AD, third century BC Israelite, that you're in sin, that you're not, you don't have a good relationship with Yah, you're not a true Hebrew. Look and see, do they have parapets on their homes? You should see this. Parapets were put on the homes because it got hot and people would go up on their homes in order to hang out and to relax. They didn't have great rooms and things and AC and all this stuff in their homes. Does that mean that air conditioning is unlawful today? No, it does not. But I'm saying that they hang out on the roofs of their homes, and so they would put these around in order that a child or someone that maybe had a little bit too much wine wouldn't fall off the house and break a leg or their neck. Also, they could be used for defense situations. If you had an attack on your city or your town, you would have something to hide behind, and you could shoot off of there your bones, your arrows, throw your spears, rocks, whatever, right? There's a modern parapet that we would see in the 21st century. We see them on mostly industrial type buildings, apartment complexes, where for insurance reasons, they put them on their buildings. Because if you have the air conditioner right there, repairman up there working, and he steps back to grab his screwdriver and plummets to his death because you had no parapet, you're going to face a lawsuit. You need railings on public places or places where people have access. We see that, but how many of us have these on our homes today? Some of you may be like me, I got one. How many of you have them because it was already there when you moved in because you live in an apartment building? Or how many have them because you're like, look, to keep Torah, I put this onto my house. I get asked this question, by the way. I get asked this question, should on my house I put a railing up on my house even though I got a slanted roof and we don't hang out on top of the house? But should we practice the principle to today? Does it mean that we just toss this law away and we do nothing with it? No. What's the principle of the law here? Protection. Safety. So you, if you are working at your home, and you got people over the feast days. I actually seen Israelites do this. I went to an Israelite place for a feast day, and they were digging a latrine, and they had a huge hole that you could fall in and break your neck. And they put up, they didn't initially, but then they got them up right away, the stakes in the ground, and then they put little banners around like watch out, caution, and they warned everybody about it. That is fulfilling Torah right here. Okay? For someone to say, not my responsibility, they shouldn't have been out there anyway. We told everyone the fellowship is over here. Do people listen? You tell a child, stay here, where do they want to be? Over there. He said, stay there, they want to be here. So then a child wanders out, falls into the hole that you didn't put protection around, and dies. Does Yahweh hold you accountable for that? 100% from laws like this. You're 100% guilty, okay? Just like if you have a dog on your property and that dog bites a visitor, same principle. If your ox gores somebody and you don't put that ox to down and it gores somebody else, goring means like they hooked you because they're a rambunctious ox and they're uncontrollable. So let's take words like dog, because many of us don't have oxes, but we have dogs. If your dog attacks somebody, and then you know and you're aware that the dog bites, and you don't take precautions, and your dog bites somebody else, you're held in contempt according to the law of Yah. You're held responsible. You have sinned against your brother. This is the way that we use Torah to guide us. Okay, let's go and look at beards. Just real fast. 2 Samuel 10:4-5. This is when Hunan, another nation's king, took David's servants and he shaved off half of their beard and then he cuts up their garments. And because of this, the servants were greatly ashamed and embarrassed because they had half their beards cut off. And David tells them, remain at Jericho until your beards have grown and then go ahead and return. Now, why wouldn't David just say, God, yeah, that's pretty embarrassing having half a beard. Why don't you go ahead and shave the other half and then come back and let it grow in full? Because the Israelite men at the time of David all had beards. It was part of their culture. Men today have taught it is commanded by Yahweh's Torah to have beards. And that if you don't, you are in sin against the Most High Yah. They're wrong. That was part of the culture, and they use verses like this to prove it. Because it was part of their culture. That's why men had beards. And another part that I'll just go ahead and say is people get confused then about shaving your head when you're mourning for the dead. So then they go and say, you can't shave your head or shave your beard at all or pluck out at all, or you're in sin. But when you go and you read in context, they were doing it for the dead. How many people in a 21st century culture in the United States or in the West are accustomed to shaving your beard or ripping it out at the root, your hair out from the root, or shaving your head in mourning for the dead? I've never experienced that. Have you? Have any of you experienced that? I've never experienced it. We don't have that. So then you try to read it and you say, no, through the 21st century perspective at our culture, we believe that that applies to us today and just shaving our beards off. No, because Yah didn't drop a divine culture on the people. Yahweh dropped a divine laws on the people that affected culture. But he was okay with a lot of the current culture of the people. He didn't mind it. Didn't bother him a bit. Wasn't his. Yahweh is a great leader because he's not a micromanager. Yahweh's not a micromanager. He focuses on the heart of the issue. All this other stuff, irrelevant. But then you have pastors out there that are micromanagers. I don't like a certain word, so you can't say that word, and now it's become a sin. What about kids? I've been around people that they say, you are sinning if you call your children kids. Yet we know the etymology of so many words, but when it comes to that word, all of a sudden we're ignorant of etymology. We're ignorant of culture. I don't know of anybody today that if I'm talking about my children, and I mean even farmers, third and fourth, we live in Nebraska, man. Our neighbors out here are farmers, our literal neighbors, farmers. And if I go over to our neighbors that have goats and I'm talking to them and I say, yeah, boy, my kids were rambunctious the other day. Oh, your goats, huh? Yeah, my goats give me problems too. No, they're going to know unless I make it clear that I'm talking about my kids' goats, the kids referring to that. I'm talking about my children. Why? Because our culture. You see that? So now let's go and look at something else. What about firstborn inheritance rights? Is that Torah? No. We don't see that. We see Yah addressing it. We see Yah even communicating to it. We see Yah even using parables to it. Why? Because the culture, the audience of that day, that was part of their culture, so they would understand it. He's communicating to people through his prophets in a way that they could understand. And we see here Genesis 29, 26, Laban said, it is not so done in our country to give the younger before the firstborn. So this is with Rachel and Leah. And he's saying, it's in our culture that we don't give the younger daughter before I would give the unmarried firstborn daughter. Tying into inheritance rights. It ties into that. Because it was also in the culture that you didn't give the blessing upon there was a blessing for the firstborn child that they would get. And then there was a blessing to the second and the third and the fourth born. But there was a special blessing to the firstborn. But like I'm showing you here, according to the daughters, that was cultural. Now let's look according to the men. Genesis 24, 2 through 3. And Adam said to his servant, the oldest of his household, this is marrying family. I wanted to share. Did I not put that there? I didn't, but I know it, so I don't have to have it there. I'll just say it. So you have Israel blessing Joseph's children, Ephraim and Manasseh. Now, who was born first? Nope. So then who was born first? Manasseh, right? And then Ephraim was born second. And Israel's sight, Jacob's sight, was failing. And he went to bless the firstborn blessing upon Ephraim, which should, according to culture, go to Manasseh. And Joseph tries to correct them and go, no, father, your hand's on the wrong one. Your right hand should be on Manasseh. You actually made a mistake and put it on Ephraim. He goes, no, I didn't. This is prophecy. So Yahweh was using Israel, Jacob, for a prophetic blessing over Ephraim, who was to be the fullness of the nations, showing that in Yahweh's law, the firstborn blessing can go to the second. It can go to the third. But in cultural law, it went to the first. You see the difference? So here we would have all of a sudden a conflict of culture and Torah among the ancient people. Let's go here. I'm going to show you this now. Marrying family. And this is where I'm trying to balance all of you out on the other side of this camera of how you were intended to approach the Bible, okay? So Genesis 24, 2 through 3. And Abraham said to his servant, the oldest of his household, who had charge of all he had, put under your hand or my thigh. And that also could be the holding of the testicles too. So thigh could be actually translated testicle, and that could be what. So do we have this in our culture today? Do you ever make an oath and grab another man by his testicles? No, in fact, you probably get knocked out by most Hebrew Israelite men if you try to grab them by the testicles. And then you say, oh, I thought we were restoring culture. I'm making a covenant between you and I. So I grab hold of the testicles to make a covenant. And you didn't surprise them. you would have like the exchange of the covenant. They would do this. So you also have in the translations under the thigh, and they would make this oath that they would seal it by doing this. But we don't see it done today, even by people who say that they are here to restore culture. However, again, pick and choosing. And it says that I may make you swear by Yahweh, the Elohim of heaven and the Elohim of earth, that you will not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell. And so at that point in time here, you would have them sending them back to your people was who? Your family. You were related. So when this servant went back to Abraham's family, who was Rebekah to his son Isaac? And family relation. Take a guess. How were they related? Isaac, Abraham's son, and Rebekah. Laban, it's cousins. 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 How many of you go to a family reunion in order to pick up women? Depending where you live, some of you may have raised your hands there and been like, don't judge me. I get questions a lot. Can I marry my cousin? And they fall in love and they want to marry cousins. You have people like Jerry Lee Lewis, the great Balls of Fire guy, the singer that everybody, goodness gracious, he married his cousin. I think even Elvis married his cousin, but I can't, that might have been rumored. The Priscilla, anyway, you have famous people that married their cousins and stuff like that. But people come back on the Bible and they say, look how horrible it is. They married their cousins. You have that way. And then you have the other way. They say, hey, we're restoring our culture. And in our Hebraic culture, we marry family members. We married cousins. So then we're going to do that today. And you might be like, no, people call, they ask me. They want to reinstitute this today and they want to marry their cousin or marry their nieces. And things like this. And I'm like, no, you can go Leviticus 18. You can talk about kinsmen, close of kin. You don't forbidden to marry. No, there were certain situations like Abraham and Sarah, who she was actually the niece. Her father died, which was Abraham's brother. and she would be left without a covering in that time. That's why Levirate laws and a lot of these laws were so important, because when you study the culture, the women would be going out and they didn't get government aid. They didn't get food stamps. They didn't get government housing. Women today, Hebrew Israelite or Gentile, they have nothing to be concerned of in the United States. They go out and they don't want to work. They don't want to get married to a man that will take care of them. They want to go and do their own thing, their own way, have many husbands, and just let the government be their husband and to take care of them. That's what they want. And then they can have a husband of the week. Okay? So, but with our people back then, that would be almost a death sentence. If your father's was dead and you couldn't go back to your father's house and he had no one to protect you, then you're going around and you're like the stranger or the foreigner. You become as one of them, that you're waiting on the outskirts to run in to glean fields and to eat. You don't have a household that you can go and be a part of. So it's such a tremendous blessing to take the woman into your home and to protect her. And that's why land inheritances were protected and all this type of thing. But again, here, when you see them sent back to their family members, they were marrying cousins. Why? Because the Bible is a family story that is communicated and brought through Abraham, who was a key component of the story. We will be doing that beautiful I'll bring you in on a neat visionary experience on that in a couple of weeks. It's beautiful how it all ties together. So we have Abraham, this story coming through. They married into their people, and that's how come ancestry logs were so important on the male side. So go back and get a daughter of our people, not this people, because we're building a nation. We're building. How is this brought forward today then? Marry cousins? I would suggest not. I would suggest not. Now, Yah, when they encountered the custom of marrying cousins, did Yah would disapprove of it? No. Did Yah would disapprove? Abraham did a righteous act by covering Sarah, but if it was just because you thought she was hot and you wanted to marry her, was that lawful? Nope. Go back and read your Bible. You're not to marry your aunt or your uncle. You're not to marry your mom or your dad. So Yah knew about the customs of marrying family, and his law comes in and he molds it, he shapes, and he forms the culture in that area. Saying you can marry family, cousins, this type of thing, but you're not going to marry these. They're too close of kin. You're not going to marry them. We see that, right? How can we do this today? Marry people in your faith. In your faith. You shouldn't be out marrying somebody of another religion and thinking you're going to proselytize them and convert them. That's ignorant behavior, because what is one sure way that the Israelite men got brought out of following Yahweh? Through the women. Through the women. And when it says you're not to make any covenants with them, remember, at that time, Yahweh spoke of certain people like the Canaanite and the Moabite, these certain nations he said don't go into covenant with, and other nations you were allowed to go into covenant with. It wasn't a problem, but certain nations you were told not to. And those are certain nations of that day that we can't define today, but people struggle because they want and they misinterpret the Bible. So how do we define that today? Because you're white? Because you're black? Because you come from this geographical location? That means you're a Canaanite, a Moabite, an Israelite, an Amorite, an Edomite. And they're trying to, and they're struggling. No, 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 no. You're trying to go back here when you got to operate in over here. In this first century or 21st century, how does it apply today? Like I said, you don't marry somebody outside your faith. And it is somebody that comes and is changing and molding. You give them time. You have witnesses that come around you that they aren't lusting after that male or a female, and that they give you good counsel, and they let you know if that person has truly converted or if they're just pretending to convert to get into your pants. See what I mean? Like I'm a Gentile, but oh, I'll go along with this Israelite thing, right? Of keeping feasts and shit sabbats and eatings and all this kind of stuff. I'll go with it only to get you. And then when I get you, oh, I'm going to change you later. People do this. So marry your own people. That's how you bring that forward today. Now let's go ahead and get moving. What about this? Numbers 31:17. Now therefore kill every male among the little ones. The Hebraic word there is a word for children, and every woman, that's an adult female, who has known a man by lying with him. But all the Young girls, same Hebraic word. Children, those, you, as we're looking at the word, you have not known, then have not known a man, they're virgins, but in line with him, you keep them alive for yourself. So what do we have here, guys? Do you realize what I just told you? That when Israel conquered this nation, and they brought out children, girls, little girls, before puberty age, he said, you keep them for your brides. You keep them for your brides. And people read this and they're just appalled. Like, these are children. It could be 10-year-olds, 11-year-olds, girls. And Yah says, you keep them. So do we want to restore culture and go out and go to neighboring communities and take their children into our community and save them for our brides? How would you feel as an Israelite man on the other side of the camera if you have a 10-year-old daughter and you have another Hebrew Israelite man visiting your homestead or your apartment or wherever you're at, and they say, geez, your daughter looks like she could have, she has good genes. I want to arrange a marriage between me and her. Like, guy, my child is 11 years old. Oh, I know. Wait till she becomes into puberty. Because we can see in places like Ezekiel, and I don't know if I have that slide on here, and I don't. But in Ezekiel, I believe it's chapter 16, when Yah was talking about taking a woman before, when she's a young woman, a young girl, before puberty, and he would clothe her and raise her up. Oh, yeah, it definitely, because if she was a baby, an infant, cast, left for dead at the side of the road. And he swallowed her. He put salt on her. He, you know, put oil on her, got her all cleaned up. And then when she reached her time of womanhood, it says, when she came into puberty, then he went into her and he made a covenant with her. So going by that little glimpse of what Ezekiel is communicating as Yah was speaking to Ezekiel and says, write this down. And Ezekiel speaking to the culture of the day, we can see in that glimpse in Ezekiel 16 that the culture would wait until the women came into puberty. And that means that the woman had her first menstrual cycle. And when that took place, she was of age to marry. How old are women that go into puberty? My wife's saying 12, 13. So if you're all about restoring the culture, and this goes like, say, like flat earth, like I read flat earth in the Bible, and so I say, because that was their perspective of that day, and that must be our perspective today. So if anybody says round earth, they're Satanists and they're against the Bible, if you come from that conclusion, you have to come from other conclusions too. Because they didn't even know about anatomy, and I can go through days of biology and different things that they didn't know in the Hebraic culture. Geology, they didn't know in Hebraic culture. They weren't aware of it, and Yah wasn't concerned of it because that was not the central core of the message. Just like when we read in Ezekiel 16, is the central core of the message to pull out of that, when can I go into a girl? When is it lawful to enter into a woman? After puberty, after her first period. When Yah saw what was taking place in the culture, Yah said that he is okay with you entering into a woman after her first period. So if we read that and see it, we say that was our ancient people. That is what we must do today to have a closer relationship with Yah. And you have camps and communities and ministries like this, and they've done it. It's recorded that they take young little girls who are 13 and 12 and have their first period, and they're not in a culture where they've been groomed for that. And understand that, because that's a culture here, and we live in a culture way over on this end, and they take these young little girls to be their brides. And they take them before the period, and they're espoused to them, engaged, until, got numbers, right? You want it, Israel, you got it. Numbers 31 right there, you have it. Yah himself speaking to Moshe, telling him what to command. And so they read this and they say, yeah, I'll take these 10-year-olds and they're espoused to me. And when their first period comes, I want the father to contact me and we're going to have a marriage ceremony. This is happening today. Because they're taking a culture and they're trying to say that Yah has a divine culture, and we read about it there, it's meant for us here. No, it's not. You're creating stumbling blocks for people because you're out there trying to be in the light for the nations, communicating the gospel message, and you have a ministry operating like that. Tell me, what person raised in the 21st century culture wants to be a part of that? Oh, I want to go to a feast day and my 10-year-old daughter is being gawked at. I ought to, wow, right? We're marrying cousins, okay? These arranged marriages, babies. I know of one place that the baby son is already having allegedly marriage proposals given. I would want my daughter to marry your son, and the son's not even a year old. Because of who the person is and their status and among that group. It's being done today, Israel. It's being done today. And it's a stumbling block for the people, and it's an unnecessary burden. And we will not do that here. We obey Torah here. But I am not about to take a first century or this whatever century culture, 20th century BC, 10th century, what we have here, and to make that on the people for today. That's ignorant. It's not good hermeneutics. It's not good biblical understanding. We don't even see the people in the Bible doing that like I showed you. You don't see them doing it in the first century. So you see that. Raping slaves. How many of these communities want to bring slavery back in? You want polygamy, multiple wives, brought back in, restoring culture. You want concubines, brought back in, restoring culture. And yet you don't even know how to rightfully operate in any one of those categories. You're reading little glimpses of it in the Bible. And you got people doing it today. And if you want to do it, by all means, we'll get there. Yah is fine with you doing that in your home. But when are you going to reinstitute slavery? When are you going to have, when someone owes you money, if they can't pay you back, they work it off, or they give you their daughter or son to work it off? I mean, I could only see what it would look like to have a white Hebrew Israelite community head, and you have black brothers and sisters and white on the community, and they're up saying, oh yeah, this black man over here is my slave. What? Oh yeah, he's working off a debt. He's a bond servant. He isn't bonded to me. We restore the biblical culture, and our people enslaved our own people to work off debts for a limited period of time, not indefinitely, unless they wanted to indefinitely become bond servants. Do you see that? Enormous stumbling block. Look at this, though. Raping slaves in the Bible, Leviticus 19:20-21. If a man lies sexually, so the slave master lies sexually with a woman who is a slave, this could be a foreign slave, or this could be an Israelite slave that's working off a debt of her household, assigned to another man and not yet ransomed. Ransomed is your key word. Other man's a key word. It says that, or given her freedom, a distinction shall be made. They shall not be put to death because she was not free. So she can be engaged to another man, and the slave master can have sex with this woman while she's engaged, and the Torah of death does not apply because she is not free at the time of the intercourse. Bible. But she, he shall bring his compensation of Yahweh to the entrance of the tent of meeting, a ram for a guilt offering. So it was sin to do it. You were sinning against her, but it didn't carry the same judgment. You would bring a ram. Well, if you have a super attractive woman and she's engaged to this other slave and she's pretty hot, she might be worth the ram. And that's how people begin to think of it. That's why Yahweh said, I require obedience and not sacrifice. But what happens when we institute laws like this today? And we say, hey, if you live on my community and you know you're working off you're a bond servant, you're working off a debt, whatever it is, and you're engaged to another man in another community somewhere, I can have sex with you. Torah says, I'll just give you one of my ram to your community. I'll just send you a nice offering. This is where it's headed. This is where it's headed. This is where it is headed. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about, as we finish up here, homosexuality, polygamy, concubines. So I want to do this real fast. In this, let's see, I can leave some of it. I just don't want to. Okay. That razor took off running from me. All right. Polygamy. Multiple wives. Multiple. And we're finishing up on this, guys. I'm not going to exhaust you today. All right. Multiple wives. Okay. Concubines. All right. Multiple wives, concubines, homosexual. Sexual. I think it's like that. Okay. I think I did it right. All right. So, okay. Now, the people. We're doing tests today. Was polygamy, multiple wives, something that Yahweh dropped out of his covenant with the people from the pattern made in the kingdom? I'll say it in a simplified term. Did Yahweh originate multiple wives here on earth among the people? No, it's common. So, stand over here. Multiple wives, bank, 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 throughout all this culture and into this first century period, was common. They all the nations, say it like that, practiced having more than one wife. It wasn't something that the Israelite people practiced only monogamy, having one wife, based off the Adam and Eve story, and the other nations had one wife as well. And then Yahweh says, as I give you my Torah and I speak to you, Moshe, tell the people that it is my biblical institution of marriage for you all to have more than one wife. And he give, and they're like, wow, this is something unique to the Israelite people. It wasn't unique to the Israelite people. Everybody was doing it. So, and again, it constitutes back into women wanting to be covered, protection, this type of thing as well. You had women being with their fathers or with their husbands or with close akin family members, protected, right? Because other people could come in and take advantage of them. So you have multiple wives all throughout this time frame, normal. Yahweh comes in and he says, look, I see you doing multiple wives. Everybody's doing multiple wives, and so does your culture. You won't be like the other people. You'll be a peculiar people, a set apart people. I have a law that's going to reshape your current culture into a holy people. So you'll do and live life in a lot of the same fashions and formats with a twist, altered into a holier context. So when it came to polygyny, Yah said, hey, I know the other nations, they will marry sisters. But I don't want you marrying sisters to vex each other. Okay? I don't want you, when you take multiple wives, other nations are amassing them, and they're diminishing the rightful blessing of the first wife, according to food, clothing, and remnant, you know, all that stuff, food, clothing, shelter, I'll say it like that, food, clothing, shelter. I'm going to diminish from that wife to take from her to give to my second wife because I can't really afford to take care of more than one. So I have to take from one to give to the other, right? So my new one, my shiny new toy, I'm going to take away from my first one and give to the new one and diminish the first one. Yah says, not in my culture, not in my people. My law will come down and reformat and say, no, that's not allowed. Yahweh also says that if you have two wives and you love the first one, but boy, you bring on the second younger one and she's real good looking and I'm more attracted to her and I'm more vibe with her, then I want my firstborn blessing to go to her firstborn seed. Yahweh says, nope, it goes to the one, it's called in the Bible, that is hated, loved less. And you see that same communication over into Jesus. If you don't hate your mother and father and love me, love less your mother and father, me. So just like you have Jacob, he hated Leah and he loved Rachel, right? He loved Leah less. He spent way more time with Rachel. Yahweh closed up the womb of Rachel and they were sisters, but you have Jacob getting tricked into that. We just saw with Laban, it's not our custom. So he was tricked into doing it. And I'll go to, anyway, it's a beautiful imagery there, but I won't do that today. So he gets tricked into it. And that's why he has the two sisters. But Yahweh says, you won't do this here. And he says, just because you love Leah less than you do Rachel, you're not to give the firstborn blessing to the womb of Rachel. This is what we have coming in our laws, right? Now, what about concubines? Concubines was done then as well. The thing with the concubine, we don't have a lot of information there. We just know that she didn't have the same status as a wife. Neither would her offspring that would come from that sexual union, okay? So she would come, she would be taken care of from the head of the home, but she wouldn't have the same status in the household. And she would not, so maybe it was the jewelry and the things that were put on the first wife, she would not get via through the marriage ceremony and stuff like that. She wouldn't have those, identifying her status in the home, and that her children would not have the inheritance rights of a wife. She could become a wife. And we see that with Abraham. We see that with the writings where it says concubine in one part and wife in the other part. So we don't know, is the word starting to be used interchangeably by the author or the translator? Or did that woman elevate in status? I'm giving you a lot, but we see that concubines were there. And today, I heard of that going to be instituted in a ministry about 6 months ago. And they're all about, we need to reinstitute the biblical culture. And they said, we are so excited that we're going to reinstitute concubines because it's part of our culture. And that these are women that aren't marriage material in their eyes, but they're burning. And so they want to reinstitute concubine so they can come and join up with a man and they can have sex. But the man, it doesn't matter if he can't afford them or not. They don't have the same status or rights. So they live in their own house and their own place and they can just have sex with each other. We're totally missing the heart of what concubines are. And it's sad, but concubines were there. So if you're on the other side of the fence that says, oh, the Bible's so disgusting because it wasn't his divine intention, because we see the garden creation to have multiple wives or concubines, because there was just Adam and Eve, male and female, and that those two, one husband and one wife, is actual biblical marriage and Yahweh's original intention. You're missing the point. Do you want to see a quick one on that? This is fast. Quick one on that. I have to use my hand. We'll be fast. This is quick. For all of you out there that believe Yahweh's intention because of Adam and Eve creation, let me show you something. We have Adam. We have Hiawatha, right? However you pronounce that. You have Eve. Adam, Eve, so first man, mother of all the living, get together, one flesh, have children. Right? So they'll say, this is biblical marriage. Is biblical marriage in one context? What's the context? Male, hope I'm not standing in the way, female. The two binary opposites join together, become one flesh. Life is brought through it abundantly. Blessings, offspring, populate the earth. Biblical marriage, male and female joining together. There you have it, forming a covenant relation. So they'll say that multiple wives is something that came later, which obviously, because we don't see another woman created for Adam, but that it wasn't Yahweh's intention. Well, I will tell you this, is that with her, what's the image of this brought forward? Of marriage. Yeshua. Biblical marriage, okay? Yeshua. Watch somebody actually get on here and go, he made a graven image of Yeshua. What's this called? The church? Assembly? So, marriage equated back here is represented over here in the illustration that is made that Yeshua is the head of the assembly and gave his life for it. And you are to be married into Yeshua, each one of us, because we make up the church. And so here is one man, one woman joined together, but is communicated through the Hebraic mindset of the East that this is polygynous, multiple, right? Because it's only one, only I can be married to Yeshua. Him and him alone have a, me and him alone have a special relationship that is private to us, and I'm the only one that's going to be saved and go into the kingdom. It's going to be me and Yeshua for eternity. No, it's going to be you. We're all plural in her to be a bride, plurality. So this is speaking in plurality that you have multiple, I'm going to add in my other brothers and sisters, my brothers and sisters, okay? This married who? To him. One husband, multiple brides, one covenant. Same communication. One husband, plurality can be communicated in Eve through via covenant that if he adds other women, one man, one covenant. He has an individual covenant with each one of these women. So you can see through the biblical marriage, male, female, come together, join, become one. You have one covenant, male, female, come together, join. You have another covenant, but this man has how many brides? Three. Same thing over here. Husbands to represent plurality of the woman via original biblical model. As it's communicated, you have multiple brides. Are we there? Hebraic mindset showing you that in creation, that it's not Yahweh's original intention for it to be one man and one woman in the covenant only via what we read. Or when you come over here, I guess it's one blessed man that's going to be the bride or, you know, of Yeshua. It's only going to be one. You can't have multiple because Yeshua is a king and he can't amass wives, right? See how we got to take everything in the context? So another thing is, to end this up on it, is that we have homosexuality also here. So when people say, hey, there wasn't two men and women, or I'm sorry, that there wasn't multiple wives given to Adam, so that's the original intention of Yah. Yahweh just tolerated sin, which he doesn't tolerate. He seeks for obedience. And throughout culture of the people, throughout this timeline, Yahweh accepted, or he just overlooked or turned a blind eye, as I had other teachers tell me, he turned a blind eye to polygyny throughout here. No, absolutely not. Polygyny was already in effect. Concubines were already in effect. Homosexuality was already in effect. When Yahweh looked on multiple wives in the culture, Yahweh's Torah, he reorganized and he gave certain laws to govern having multiple wives to make it holier than the way that the nations did it. The same way with concubines. He saw the concubines and he protected the concubines in his law. When Yahweh saw homosexuality in the culture, what did he do? Because all the nations were doing homosexuality as well. It was rampant. But when he saw homosexuality, Yahweh forbid it in any way, shape, fashion, or form. He forbid it. Plucked it right out of the culture. When Yahweh saw multiple wives, polygyny, concubines, did he forbid it? No, he didn't. So see, I have to speak to the other side. While I warn people about the multiple wives, I yet acknowledge that it's not sin. But then what have I seen? What's the problems? Is that people read and say, hey, we see multiple wives in the culture, and I make the mistake of saying it's biblical marriage, that multiple wives is contained in the Torah as it was given from Yah unto the people, which it was not. And thereby is a man, and this is taught, and this has caused families to be destroyed. I know this. Is that if I'm a man coming into the faith, and I've been in X amount of time, could even be a year or whatever, and I got a good source of income, and I have a wife who's come in, and we barely even got the feast days down, right? We're just coming in. And then I learn about multiple wives, and my pastors and teachers and everybody have multiple wives, and everybody's doing it. They're just taking it on and don't even know exactly what they're doing, but they're doing it, right? And so they bring them in. Then I want to do it. What I have heard being communicated to people is that if your wife isn't ready, because your household's not in order to bring on another wife, is what's being said. Your household's technically out of order because you as the man should be teaching and conditioning your wife for that. But she says, when we made our covenant before Yah, and we knew exactly who we were calling on when we made a covenant before Yah, right? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And it was communicated that if I took another wife, that that's adultery and betrayal of the covenant and the worst thing that you could possibly do to me. Then we come into where we read about a culture that it was accepted, which is not part of our culture today in the Western area where I live, but in parts of the globe or the earth it is accepted. Anyway, we would say that the man can bring in another wife, and if you don't like it, then you pack your bags and get out. And that was told to women, is being told to women. Yet when you have Paul, who said to people that believed that if an animal was slaughtered in a certain way or may have been to another god, they didn't really know, and so they wouldn't eat meat because of their superstitions. Paul says, I know from faith I can eat that meat. It's clean. It's clean to be eaten. It's actual food by law of Torah, okay? But because of your weak conscience, I will never eat meat in front of you again, lest I be a stumbling block onto you. That would be reckoned as sin to me, because there's nowhere in the law that is commanded to eat meat. So what is it to me if I eat meat or only vegetables, right? That's what's being communicated. So you expect me to believe that it's acceptable to Yah, that if we live in this culture that is not conditioned to polygamy and we're just coming into the faith and everything, that I want to have another wife, so I bring her in, and if it's a stumbling block because my house is not in order and not ready to bring on other wives, that it doesn't matter my household isn't in order. By goodness, I'm the authority, and it's my right to bring in other women, so I'm just going to do it, and if you leave, so the heck on. And they do leave, and they stumble right out of the faith. What do you think Yah's going to think about that? Because they're taking something that's not contained in here as commanded and making it and treating it as such. Now, if you are in a situation where it's keeping the Shabbat, eating clean, raising your children according to the law, the celebration of holidays, yes, you are not to, if your wife wants to leave, so be it, right? In my house, we're going to serve Yah, because that is commanded, and that is part of the covenant Torah. That says a whole lot, right? upsetting the culture. Two slides, Galatians 3, 28 through 29. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female, for you are all one in Yeshua HaMashiach. And if you are Messiahs, you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. And that was mind-blowing to the culture of the first century. It would be as upsetting as me talking about flat earth or me talking about multiple wives or concubines or any of that. Horribly upsetting, because they would go back to the Bible and say, no, Israel is Yahweh's firstborn son. Israel is the apple of Yahweh's eye. Israel is a special people above all people of the earth. And now you're trying to tell me there's neither Jew, homeborn, or foreigner, Greek? Totally upsetting, because the Jew people wanted to have a status above the Gentile people. You're telling me there's no male or female? We're on equal footing? I just brought you from Torah on that, didn't I? That Adam named Eve, showing where that he was the head of the home and she was a helper. But he says, no, there's neither male nor female. You're both imaging Yah in Messiah, a revolutionary of the day. What about this? Romans 10, 12. For there is neither distinction between Jew and Greek. That means Hebrew Israelite bloodline, or grafted in and accepted as bloodline, versus foreigner, one of another nation. For the same master is master of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. There's no distinction. No distinction. No difference. That's as upsetting today for people as it was back then. Totally revolutionary, upsetting the culture. How are we doing? Let's get some questions going. And I appreciate, I'm sure, and again, I might look at a few questions. I don't want to like go another 3 hours, because this is just going to create lots of questions, right? Like, well, in what way? Because you have to go, and what we'll do, I wanted you to have a little bit of the grounds, and you can read, guys. I'll put these links in the description, but I have books like Symbolism of the Biblical World, okay? You have books like this, and I'll put the links when this is posted. Ancient Near Eastern Thought of the Old Testament, have that in there. Manners and Customs of the People. When you study the culture, if you don't know the culture and you don't divest yourself into it, when you read it and you bring it forth and you try to apply it and live it out today over here, you're going to mistranslate, you're going to misinterpret, and you're going to miss a lot of things. You're going to be doing lots of unnecessary ways of life and bring unnecessary burdens on the people that Yahweh never intended to have happen. And yet I would be one, like I said earlier, to encourage you that if you're one that has done some restoration processes, as long as it doesn't put a stumbling block before other people in their faith and in their walk, I think it's beautiful. If you want to live in a tent, if you want to wear a tunic, beautiful. Good for you, right? I think good for you. Somebody said, do I have an official stance on how to get to heaven? Follow Yeshua HaMashiach. Follow Jesus Christ, his example. And by faith in him alone, in declaring him as master of all, declaring him as the one, that Yeshua HaMashiach, that lived and died for our transgressions, that he is the one that the biblical authors were communicating about, and that this Bible is a story that leads to him. And that when you declare that, and then through the fruit of your works, you begin to emulate and pattern your life after his. That's how you walk out your salvation to get into the kingdom. But confessing Yeshua, belief in him and him alone is your entrance. He's the only door, the only way into the kingdom of heaven. Doesn't matter how many Sabbaths you keep or how much pork you never ate. You know, I have not had one thing unclean enter into my mouth, right? It doesn't matter. If you lose sight of Yeshua and that all roads point to him, you've missed it. Good. Here. Oh, okay. Anything else? There's a mic. Shh. Okay, you're gonna be on mic. All right. I want to. Beautiful teaching. Wait till we start building off of it. So, being married, I'm not to have another wife, right? That's up to you. Now, the way it was done in biblical order, we can see how Yah came in and he gave his commandments concerning polygamy, multiple wives. And he said that a man or a woman's not to have multiple husbands, that that's forbidden. But a man having multiple wives, I could care either way. You could have multiple, you could have one, you could have none. You decide. But in the area of multiple wives, I'm going to give you what I define as good and evil in the area of multiple wives. And he tells you, you know, you're not to diminish from the first wife to take on a second. So if you can't afford to keep up the life of the first wife in the ways that she's acclimated and she's sustained, you can't take your first wife and move her out into a tent and then bring your second wife into the home type of thing, right? Or say, you know, first wife, you're only going to eat on Tuesdays and my second wife will eat on, you know, you'll go every other day eating. You can't do that. So I'll just flat out say, you, Brother Greg, you can have another wife and it is not sin according to the Torah of the Most High. However, if you have a first wife and she is not, she voices her concerns and that she's not ready and that it would crush and destroy her spirit, you have to look at the reasons why you are bringing in another wife. Because if you bring one in anyway and she stumbles out of the faith, what you have declared is the value of bringing in something that's not commanded was so valuable and important to my life, I'm going to have to one day explain to Yeshua HaMashiach why she was so important to bring into my family at the sake and the destruction of my first wife. And just hope between you and Yeshua that your reason is substantial. And it's not based off, well, I saw these ancient Israelite guys doing it. So I just felt if David can do it, so can I. But you're not David and you weren't in his circumstances and situation, right? You weren't in his time and in his culture and his area. So anyway, that basically, it is not a sin to have more than one wife. However, if you bring one in, you can create a stumbling block. That other wife goes out. You could have sinned against her by not having your house in biblical order to bring in another wife.
Do you believe that you have to be baptized to enter into the kingdom of heaven?
No.
John?
Nope. You do not have to be baptized in order to enter the kingdom of heaven. You have the man that was up on the stake next to Yeshua. He declared who Yeshua was by faith and confessed the name of Yeshua. We don't know that man was keeping Shabbats before that. I mean, a man was up there for some crime, right? And he was guilty where Yeshua was innocent. And he admitted he was guilty. So it wasn't that he was, you know, convicted of a crime he actually didn't do. So that man up there said he was guilty. He doesn't say that he kept Shabbats or was baptized or had the Holy Spirit baptism of fire or anything. He confessed Yeshua was master of all. And Yeshua says, I will be with you this night in the kingdom. So no, you don't have to have water baptism to enter in the kingdom. But those that believe, according to Mark chapter 16, and are saved shall be baptized. But it doesn't stop there, does it? They should also will have signs following them, confirming the word and the testimony of their belief, right? So if you believe in Yeshua, why are you not getting baptized? There's no reason that you should forsake the baptism.
Is baptism by immersion cultural compared to sprinkling?
It could be. That could be a cultural. I would say that, yeah, so when the biblical authors equated baptism through them passing through the Sea of Reeds, through what's commonly called the Red Sea, as they passed through, as the waters were separated on the right and the left, and they went through, they were immersed in that water as a baptismal. Because when you're baptizing a million people, that's the way that that's going to be done. And so the idea of the baptismal was also being buried. So you would die and resurrect anew. So they left all of Egypt, they were supposed to, on that side of the Red Sea. And on the other side was their new life that they were to have. And as long as their culture that kind of came through didn't transgress the Torah of Yah, Yah was okay with it. But when their culture became in opposition to the Torah of Yah, you defected the Torah of Yah, right? Because part of the culture was making graven images, and that's what they did. They made a golden calf. Bad, got rebuked and corrected over it. But the idea of going into water was the death. So it was in symbolic at the time of John the Immerser that when you were sunk in the water as you were being buried, you were dying and be resurrected. You also bring that back in to the mitzvah, the ceremonial washings. And that was a ceremonial bath. So you went into the water. When you look back through the priesthood and their rituals and all of it communicated and brought forth, because believe me, I wondered, where did this baptism come from? We don't see this charge of baptism, but the ceremonial washings we see, the equating and the drawback in the book of Hebrews to the crossing of the Red Sea. So I would say, yes, it is cultural. And no, I do not see the sprinkling of water on a person being anything that we read about in the Bible. Okay, but I don't get so technical that I would say I prefer to baptize and will go out of my way to baptize in living water. But I also know what makes the water living. It's not living of its own self. It's living because of it being sustained by Yahweh, Yeshua HaMashiach, right? So I prefer not to baptize in a swimming pool or a non-living body of water for me.
Do you believe that you have to have the Holy Spirit to get to heaven? If so, what are the signs of the Holy Spirit? Thank you for answering.
Yeah, so yes, the Holy Spirit is a sign that you are sealed until your day of redemption. This what it was there to be a sign to show you that you're sealed. That was how was the Holy Spirit used at the time the Holy Spirit was poured out on all flesh to confirm the word that was being preached. That they were the ones, the signs and wonders that came through the Holy Spirit. And also to show that the Gentiles that were being drawn in from the banner that was being put up as a sign to all nations, Yeshua HaMashiach, and that was being communicated through the Hudim, the Jewish people at the time, out to the nations, the foreigners. And as they were being drawn in, the Jewish people, the prodigal son, okay, that parable is this happening. The restoration of the house of Ephraim coming in to the house of Judah is the story of the prodigal son. And so as they came in, the homeborn son that never left said, I don't want you in, I want you out. Well, we need Yah, the father, to say, no, I'm bringing him in, I'm clothing him, I'm putting a ring on him and giving him the staff and restoring my son. How do we prove that? Besides me just saying it as a preacher. Who says so? I'm Peter, and I said so. My name's Kepha, and I said so, right? Yah had to answer, and how does Yah answer? Through the giving of his Ruach, his Holy Set Apart Spirit. So when they would come in, they would say, how can any man deny them coming in, for they have the Holy Spirit sign upon them? Now, where we have issues is because of our desensitization to the manifestation of spiritual enactments of Yah. And what I'm communicating there is that people begin to think everything's a sleight of hand, everything is made up, there's no power today, there's no healings, there's no resurrections, there's no speaking in tongues, there's no casting out of devils. They try to diminish all of that because they themselves cannot do it, because they themselves are void of the Holy Spirit. But when we come over, we think we're so less and that we can't receive, that even when Yah gives us the Holy Spirit, we don't manifest the gifts of the Holy Spirit because of all the garbage in our minds. But when we acknowledge that it's not by our own righteousness that we are saved, but it is by Yeshua's righteousness, then we're going to get there. What did I just say? That the Holy Spirit is given to those who believe and confess on the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. The Holy Spirit is a promise that they should receive. So you should not, and it's not biblical, to have people that confess Yeshua obey the commandments, live a life according to the Torah with faith in Christ, and yet they go year after year after year claiming they don't have the Holy Spirit. You are calling Yahweh a liar. Or you think you got to get to a certain place in order to receive. No, the problem is most people hadn't even heard. I mean, so much as heard about this Holy Spirit. So they had to be educated to what it was and the gift that they were going to receive. But the Holy Spirit gift should come soon after your acceptance and proclamation of an open testimony of your faith in Yeshua. And the gifts will come. Just because you don't have a gift of tongue or a gift in healing does not mean that you can't operate in it. That doesn't mean you will never speak in tongues and that you will never lay hands on people and they recover. It may be you don't have the gift in that area, but the Holy Spirit will work in and through you, and through the name of Yeshua, those things will occur and happen. And I did a teaching on that too, that it, stick with us on our channel and you'll get more education on that. So, because I believe people have been deceived that they have to jump through all these hoops to receive the Holy Spirit. Like they have to say hallelujah, hallelujah, you know, go to a certain feast day or be at Pentecost or do this or to do that, be with a certain church or a certain brother or whoever to receive the Holy Spirit. And I've seen Yah perform and do the exact opposite to open the eyes of the people, and yet they still remain blind. And by saying that, men and women would go to feast days at a certain place, jump through all the hoops, and perform all the theatrics that they were told that they needed to do, never receive the Holy Spirit, go and travel back home in disappointment, pray to Yah their nightly prayers, bam, and get hit with the Holy Spirit and start screaming out in tongues. Bam! Why? Yahweh wanted to show you it's not by your righteousness. It's not something that can be paid and bought with a price. It's a promise and it's a gift that you will receive the Holy Spirit. Okay, so I want to say a few things because I generally forget. All right, so this Thursday, just keeping it simple, Thursday night, the 28th, is the new moon. All right? So that's the new moon. And then what we do for the new moons, as it's talked about in scripture, they celebrated the new moons, that it's not a Shabbat. It becomes confusing to people who keep the lunar Sabbath, which I don't agree with. I agree with, obviously, because I'm here on Shabbat, on the seventh day Sabbath. I believe that is scripture. When the sun and the moon weren't created till like day four, I believe. How do you have then the Sabbath would be from day four, 7 days later, right? Because that's the way they did do it today. But they do the Sabbath 3 days later from day four, so that there's only 3 days from the creation of the firmaments in the heavens to the seventh day Sabbath. Anyway, they get confused when I say that the new moon's not a Sabbath, because to them it is a Sabbath. So anyway, Thursday the 28th is a new moon. What we do, we have something special to eat. We usually barbecue with, you know, if there's any like-minded believers in your area, get them over, hang out, have fun. We worship Yahweh, we blow the shofar, we sing songs, and we have a great old time, okay? So that will be this. 9 weeks from today is the Feast of Trumpets. So we want to get ready for that. Feast of Trumpets is in 9 weeks. If you plan on coming here to North Platte, Nebraska, you can Google that, see how far you are away. Get a hold of me. I want to know who you are before I give you my home address, because this is the way we are today. We're here. We're not back here where we lived in close proximity a lot. Atonement, 10 weeks. Sukkot, only 11 weeks away. I've heard from several of you that you have plans on going to Sukkot, which will be for us in Zion, at Mount Zion in Utah. Is that the Zion, Utah? Is that the way it's communicated? I put it on, it's on my Facebook page. It's a national park. If you go to my Facebook page, I have my itinerary pinned to the top. Go to Facebook, search Teacher Eric. If you do not use Facebook, email me at teachereric@yahoo.com, and I will send you out, as I've done to several of you, my itinerary. I'll put this up to you. There's my P.O. box if you need it. Email address. Hit me up there, and I will get you all the information that you need. Some people have said, hey, due to the health restrictions and the age groups that we're bringing? Is it wrong for us to be like in a little cabin or a hotel room or in a camper connected to electricity? No, there's nothing wrong with that. So we will be in tents. Again, culture, right? They were in tents. They were in a temporary dwelling. Yeshua tabernacled, Yahweh tabernacled with man in a temporary dwelling. So I look at it, and I know people say, well, isn't a hotel room a temporary dwelling? But I view it more to be tents, cultural, okay? So I do that because I want to. I'm not telling you you are in sin if you don't stay in a tent. So get a place that has electricity, but you better be getting a hold of me to let me know that we're coming. When we're at Mount Zion, the way we're going to organize it, we're staying at the Watchman Campground in Mount Zion. And the dates of the feast days are on my site. That's going to be Tabernacles October 10th through the 17th for us. October 10th through the 17th. Trumpets, by the way, is September 25th at sunset. We'll have a service, in, just so you know, September 25th at sunset. Sunday night what? Oh, okay, well, all I'm saying is that September 25th at sunset is trumpets. October 5th is atonement. That's the day portion. So October 4th at sunset would bring you into atonement. October 10th through the 17th is tabernacles. And yeah, the 9th. Okay, so anyway, get a hold of me, teacher@yahoo.com. And the reason being is that we want to try to organize and know who's coming. All right. And then what we will do there, you don't have to be so concerned that you get in the same campground that I'm in. But if you want to, great. We will find a commons area that we will all meet at. I'll make sure you all know. So that's why I want you to email me so we can get your phone numbers, ways to communicate, so we can send things out to you, itineraries and whatnot, that you know where we're going to be. Because we want to be able to all come together in a holy convocation and holy meeting groups. And we will do this at a public place. So there's that. The other thing I want to mention, offerings. So thank you to all the people who send in support. And like I said before, if you want to support me, go and feed the hungry. Go and minister the gospel to people. Help people in need as you put a jack around them and give them a hug. Tell them how much Yeshua HaMashiach loves them. And be the light that you should be to the nations. If it's something where you want to send money in, again, I always set that aside. I'm going to say, how do I want to do this? I won't say that these people sent money, but these people have supported me because some people don't like their names called. But I feel terrible. I always try to respond to every single person that's ever sent anything to support. So these people have shown to support. The other people, I've already contacted you. These people, I don't believe I was able to because when you supported me, I didn't have a way to get back a hold of you. So we have Danny Ding. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. Guardian Angel Transportation. The House of Stinson. I think it's Brother Keith. Motivation, Mike Fleming. Maria Hawk. Sorry. Nicholas Lewis. Abe Gunther, Angela Turner, Tom Martin, Sister Hannah, and then, I mean, all the other, the only reason they got called publicly is I didn't have a way to let them know privately that I appreciate and acknowledge what they sent. It just didn't go into a proverbial black hole somewhere. So anyway, I know some people don't like their names being mentioned. So I mentioned that. If you want support or help from the ministry here, we will try you. We will find out your situation. We will meddle in your affairs because we aren't going to be, time frames, right? Somebody on the internet that you can take advantage of. Somebody that you can disobey the commandments. Somebody that you're the head of your home and you have women and men or people underneath your authority and headship in your house, and then they don't work. We see in the biblical culture, that's another one, that women weren't working, that's because women couldn't go out and get jobs a lot of times. But over the time, that changed. Hence, Proverbs 31, the Proverb 31 woman, which is what a man was writing, that the wise sayings of his mother in Proverbs 31. And so she went out and worked. We have an Acts, Paul going down by the riverside to a woman who had her own house. She worked. It talked about her working. Did we get that? So women can biblically work. But it's your prerogative. If you want your woman at home with your children, that's your right, and you should do that. But your woman should not be getting a hold of another ministry then asking for money. That is unbiblical, because you have taken on that accountability. So she needs to go to you to ask for money. And if she's not being fed and taken care of, well, for one, you're not doing your duty. And then you need to reach out as the man of your house and to communicate. And in that, you're going to be tried, and we're going to get really nosy and very offensive probably to you. Okay? Because I'm going to look at, is it truly needful? Because I know through my own experiences that Yahweh takes you through things to try you to see, where does your faith come from? Money or him? What does the Jubilee year communicate to the people? That it's not from our own hand we have all these things, but we trust in the hand of Yahweh to provide all these things. So Yahweh will bring you through, and he never lets his people go hungry or begging for bread. So I will watch some of you, even if you're homeless, I watch to see Yahweh bring you through. And there's little tweaks and things and advice that can be given to you that you get back up on your feet again, and you never had to get a dime. You see that? And you're all the better for it. So I think that's enough, right? Anything? Yeah, I say hand up, not a hand out. So you guys out there that are with us, that's the way you need to be in your geographical locations. It's a hand up, not a hand out. So you don't drive by someone hungry and just go, here's some money, eat, be blessed. You know, you would have, that doesn't accomplish it. You got to go out and you got to help these people to build them up into where they should be. And you feed them. You don't make them jump through hoops to eat. You're feeding and you're taking care of, but you're building up. We're trying to restore people here. Teaching them the fish. Yeah, teaching them the fish. Right? Okay. Father, I thank you so much that we can come through and have these words of truth brought into our heart, that it's a good foundation as the messages come forward, that we can use this type of message to build off of it and to bring restoration to Yahweh's people. And we have a balanced scale in our lives. Thank you, Yeshua. So be it. All right. Bless you, Israel. Rest assured, your king, he is God.